time. My dreamy friend, it's coffee time. Let's listen to some jazz and rhyme and have a cup of coffee. Let me show a little coffee house I know, where all the new bohemians go to have a cup of coffee. Greeting time, the music box is beating time. It's good old-fashioned meeting time. So grab a chair and dig me there, 'cause that's just the place that I'm at. Coffee time, my dreamy friend, it's coffee time. Let's sing this silly little rhyme and have a cup of coffee.
What's up, boys? How you guys doing out there? Hey, yo.
Rock and roll.
What's going on, guys? This is not Graham Stephan. We're pregame, and it's the pregame show.
Graham Stephan pregame. What an exciting day.
Hey, I hope you guys are doing well out there, huh? How you doing, Amish? You feeling good?
I'm good, man. I'm rock and roll. I'm awake. I took a cold shower for this.
Woo! You got to.
Shower. I said, woo!
For Graham Stephan?
Give me that favor.
Yeah, said, you got to be ready. You got to bring
Graham
your
Stephan's coming? I said, Lord, give me that favor. That's it. I woke up this morning, I said, God, Graham Stephan's coming. 500,000 subs or whatever.
500,000 subs? He's got like 2 million.
Isn't he like 2.5 million actually?
Guys, we're in the presence of the personal finance king right now. He's slaying it. And we're going to talk to him. It's going to be a very interesting podcast. I'm going to try to get into everything, right? Listen. The drip is for everyone. So we're not going to go super hard. But at the same time, there's questions we have to address. Graham are hopefully going to roast each other's YouTube channel. We're going to get into it, guys. It's going to be a good show. You better believe it's going to be a good show.
You got to get into it. You got to be here for the community. Look, I'm going to say this right now. Big Graham Stephan fan. I like his prosperity message. So I can't wait to
ask
him.
You're big on the prosperity game. He's a little bit of a Joel Osteen, right? Like one thing that I want to talk to him about, he never deals in the negative. Have y'all noticed this? He never will say anything negative. So we're gonna try to break that trend. We'll see if we can do it. But first, hey, let me say something positive, okay? Let's talk positive. It's time to crack a cold one. It's 5 Uh-oh. O'clock somewhere. We just hit 200,000 subscribers. Pardon my Windows sound, boys. 200K.
A bottle of champagne.
How about that, huh? Hey. I hope you guys are relaxing. You can have some coffee. Whatever you want. Listen, we don't judge you. This is the content we need, boys. This is the content we need. Don't worry, guys. Graham Stephan's coming soon. He's coming very soon. He's coming at 4 o'clock. So that's 40 minutes from now. 40 minutes, we're going to be talking. What's up? What is that?
Clinkety clankety.
Yeah, clink clank.
Oh, wait. This way. What am I thinking? Oh, yeah. Boop. Oh, we hit it.
We did it.
The champagne. Zonin.
The champagne. Okay. Dude, we're chilling. James, Johnny, congrats on the 200K. Thanks, buddy. I'll be joining you real soon. We're going to get to the 400K. We're going to call that. So we have Senior 100K. We've got Detective 200K. And we're going to have, it's just in honor of the tradition, we're going to have something every tier. I think 400K should be Johnny 400K. What do you think?
Yeah, Johnny 400. Johnny 400?
Is Johnny still at 400 or is he like blown past that? What's Johnny at?
What's Johnny at? It's crazy. The calling out the prosperity. You see how much money there is in prosperity? And what y'all dealing in negativity and in lack, you're talking about the hundreds of thousands. You know, you look 200, at this guy,
200,000, watch your mouth. 200,000, watch your mouth.
Y'all okay. Talking in the hundreds of thousands. Graham Stephan's in the mail.
Listen, let me tell you this, though. Let me tell you this. I really, it's not even a joke. I truly believe that we have the strongest community on the entire platform.
Oh, yeah.
Like, per person that we have, the excitement, the fervor we have from our... from our fans, it's insane.
They love it.
They love it. And you'll never get that with positivity. You got to be negative to get the fans.
Look, you got to say the whole story too. You can't just pretend that it doesn't exist. And I do feel like in the sales circle, it's like a, hey, that's negativity.
Yeah,
it's
we'll like, pretend it's like, it doesn't exist. It. Right, right.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's see what the people are saying. Sorry, Graham. We're going to have to cover up your face real quick to see what the people are saying. Coffeezilla, what are they saying? Congrats on 200K, my G. Anything for Sifu? What do we have here? I want to be a fake guru. Iced Coffeezilla. Yeah, guys, this is a 50 cent iced Coffeezilla experience.
Oh, yeah. Midweek special.
Coffee breaks way past that, though. Where's the button for coffee break? Hey, true.
Uh-oh.
Maybe I should just abandon Coffeezilla for 2 years and then go back over to Coffee Break, and then we'll just swap back and forth. I'm just going to leapfrog my channels. I'm going to build up Coffeezilla till past Coffee Break, and then I'm going to quit Coffeezilla, and I'm going to go back to Coffee Break, and I'm going to build that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a little offended that they haven't come over and subscribed. I mean, guys, we're the Coffee Break fans. Come on. You can't do the second channel?
Come on, people. Come on.
Come on. You can't give a sub on the second channel? No, but our fans are intense, though. They love us. I've heard that other shows go live Friday mornings, and they complain. They're like, oh, my God, I can't get the listeners.
Oh, really? They go, that's the Coffeezilla hour.
I can't get some listeners on my live thing. Oh, yeah, someone else is complaining about it.
I believe that's probably true, Amish.
One of these sales guys. They try to do a Friday morning podcast, same time as us. And they said, I can't. It's no bueno. I'm moving in on a time slot here.
Dude, love from India. How did this collab happen, Coffee? Look, me and Graham have, chatted back and forth pretty early on, you know, back when both of us were much smaller. And we've been meaning to get to it, but it just hasn't happened. We got to talk to Graham, though.
Yeah.
Hopefully sort out some issues, but also just talk. You know, we're not here. Yeah.
Let's do some history, too, right?
We're kind of a Joe Rogan experience. We want to get everyone on. We do. We're going to call them out, but we're also going to get everybody on and just talk, you know?
Look, man, sometimes it's not about, like, berating someone and yelling at someone. Then we're no better than the cancelers.
Yeah. Yeah.
We need to talk, and we need to say, tell us why you think that and see if we can change their mind a little bit. It can't just be, like, all berating a guy. I think he's cool.
That's what the people are here for, though. They want...
I like his prosperous outlook, Steven. I like his prosperity mindedness.
You're into the Joel Osteen stuff, dude. You're secretly 2 weeks away from becoming Joel Osteen. You guys know right before this, Amish was telling me he wants to set up his ashram, his digital ashram for you guys.
Digital ashram. Yep. We're making the plans. We got the location. It's on an electron. You go in the meditation, we go into the electron, we go into the atom, into an electron. No. Over there, digital ashram, and it's got everything, dude. We're setting it up good. It's got good stuff. Got wormholes all over.
Gypsy Lab, are we afraid of being canceled? Absolutely not. We've already been canceled. And now what we mean by that is we've already said something so stupid that they're going to cancel us in the future. So that's what it is.
Yeah.
It is what it is. Graham Stephan is the GOAT. Nothing but clickbait titles now. Ooh, two controversial opinions.
Uh-oh.
Let's talk about it.
Uh-oh. Well, we have a Ravens fan, $5. We just got, thank you, Ravens fan. Just got contacted by a dude that works for an MLM, Vector Marketing or something.
Oh, isn't that Cutco?
Vector Marketing.
I think that's Cutco. Yeah,
that's a great name.
My friends did that. I had a bunch of friends getting into that.
Yeah, I've heard of Vector. Vector's a tight name because it makes it feel like, hey, we're going somewhere.
I've got, what is it? Magnitude and direction or something? Isn't that the definition of a vector?
Yeah, vector. Yeah, we're both engineers. We know.
Yeah, we know. Yeah. What's up? Vector. You guys might not know that. Do y'all know we're both engineers by training?
And
both of us.
Brown.
Listen, hey, And both of us aren't doing anything with it. College is a scam, guys. That's it.
You College heard it here is a scam. First. College is a scam. Why can't Graham teach a class or two? You know, that's what I'm saying.
Dude, one thing I want to talk about. I saw this thing. Yeah. Listen right here. There's this Forex guy right now who just uploaded the worst video I've ever seen. And the people in his comment section are just going nuts, and I don't understand it. It's called quitting your day job in 12 months from a multimillionaire. Hold on. From a multimillionaire. Quitting your day job in 12 months from a multimillionaire. Why? You like from a multimillionaire? That's funny, right?
I like. He's prosperity-minded, I can already tell, and I like that. I like his prosperity mindset.
Why I hate 9-to-5 jobs. And he basically says, hey, you think my 4X course is a scam? 9-to-5 jobs are the scam. Woo!
Woo! I love the turnarounds, dude.
What a stupid idea. Hey, he goes, you're afraid to pay me $500, but you go and work for... He goes, 9-to-5s are a scam. And then I was looking and I was like, well, where did you work? And he goes, yeah, how do I know 9-to-5s are a scam? I worked for JCPenney for 2 months. And I decided they're all scams.
Yeah, man. Kevin O'Leary has a banger video. You know what Kevin O'Leary's video is? He goes, it says, a salary is the price for your dreams.
Yeah, what an idiot. These people are idiots.
He's on Cameo.
No, incorrect, dude. Why do these people hate 9-to-5 jobs? You're more likely to become a millionaire from a 9-to-5 job and just saving and being responsible with your money than you are from starting some random startup and being like the next Bill Gates. It's just the truth.
Salary is the price.
Entrepreneurship is a bit of a Ponzi scheme and a bit of a scam because they all tell you, you can do it. The truth is most people can't. That's the truth. That's the facts. Almost anyone can work a 9-to-5 job their entire life, live very well, it doesn't take any risk. Like 9-to-5s rock, dude. I mean, it sucks to go to work. I get it. But
yeah, you should appreciate a 9-to-5, man. If someone's just paying you in advance, it's like you might be useless. Sorry, already paid me. Like, you know, I kind of feel bad for them. And then they got to do all the paperwork for you. Like, every time they hire someone, it's a lot of money.
Look, everyone says, like, 9-to-5 suck. And it's like, yeah, but you don't understand. You work way less with a 9-to-5. You have way more free time than you do as an entrepreneur. If you want to be a successful entrepreneur, nobody talks about that. It's like,
no responsibility.
9-to-5s are not the trap. Entrepreneurship is, well, it's a time trap. If you're happy doing it, God bless you. That's what I decided to do. But... people don't talk about the fact that unless you're happy to do that, like, be careful before you get into entrepreneurship because otherwise you're going to spend your whole life working. You have to be workaholic. Otherwise, you'll never work.
Yeah.
So this guy says, hold on, let me get to the point, Amish.
Let's get to this guy.
So he starts talking about millionaires. Okay.
Of course.
And he starts to say, okay.
College, scam. Everything else, not a scam. Open up your mind.
College, scam. Everything else, not a scam. Open up your mind. Now listen to this stat.
Everything else?
It'll be a lot farther. There's no reason why more millionaires and billionaires dropped out of college and chased their dreams than those who graduated. Like, look that up. It's a statistic. There's more millionaires and billionaires who dropped out of college than those who finished college.
Hey.
I like that's the ring on a finger move.
Hey, it's a statistic. I looked it up. What did he just say to you? Drop out, because otherwise you won't be a millionaire or a billionaire. There's more millionaires and billionaires that are dropouts than went to college. Hey, Amish, what percentage of that statement is true? Because I looked it up.
Oh, no, that's not true. That's just bullshit.
Yeah, what percent of it is true?
What percentage? It's like a
zero percent of it's true. I looked it up. True. This guy is 100% an idiot. Hey, that's a statistic. I looked it up. It's just a statistic.
Okay. Listen, I'll tell you this, that ring on the finger, power move, dude. I like that.
It's a power move.
I like he's just waving it in your face. How do you think I got this?
But listen. You know, actually, the stats on it, it's actually the complete opposite way. So I looked it up.
Yeah.
30 millionaires, which is something they call people who are worth $30 million or more.
Yeah.
80% of them have a college degree. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Huge percentage. I mean, if you want to increase your chances, you can literally 4X your chances. No pun intended. 4X your chances. Okay. By getting a college degree. But do you know about billionaires? It's even worse because, Amish, literally all these guys online right now, everyone's heard this. Like, tell me in chat if you've heard this. Have you ever heard like the saying like, well, Steve Jobs was a dropout. Yeah. Hey,
Elon Musk,
Bill Gates was a dropout. No, Elon Musk went to Princeton.
Oh, Elon Musk finished his school. Yeah, but those two are dropouts. And then it's sexy to be a dropout now.
Yeah. It's sexy to be a dropout. It's like, yo, let's rock on, dude. Hey, let's drop out together, bro. Let's become billionaires, bro. And nobody's more passionate about it than these entrepreneurs. They all go, hey, I'm the next Steve Jobs, baby. I don't need to go to school. All right, let's look at the stats, bro. Let's look at the stats. 80% of 30 millionaires went to college. 90% of billionaires went to college. Only 11% dropped out. Meaning you can literally 10x your chances, 10x it, baby, of becoming a billionaire if you go to school. And that is the real statistic.
Look, one thing to mention about Bill Gates and Zucks is that they dropped out when they had a tight opportunity. They didn't just drop out, man.
Yeah, they were already like in Harvard. Weren't they? Like, they were already in great schools, and then they dropped out. People are, like, going to community college. They go, hey, it's a good time to drop out and become Bill Gates. Yeah. It's like, dude.
and their business took over, no? Like didn't Zucks start Facebook? He goes
to
university.
Yes, of course, of course. But these people are giving such bad advice. It's so crazy how bad this advice is. And then everyone in the comment section, look at these comments, bro. Look at these comments. Honestly. You tell people you want to be a Forex trader and they'll scream for the rooftops that it's a scam because they lost money in it and then go work their 9-to-5 jobs. LMAO.
Roasted. Woo! Roasted.
It's like, dude. That's not true. Like, of course, these people don't understand relative risk. Yeah. In fact, they don't understand math at all. I can't be bothered to find it. But at some point in this video, this guy's like, I didn't learn anything from school. Like, what? Y equals MX plus, I don't know, whatever that equation is.
Oh, yeah. Let's
like,
see
I've
let's
never
see
used that before. It's like, you're a Forex trader, you idiot. You better be using math. Are you kidding?
Be a lot farther. There's no reason why more millionaires and billionaires dropped out of college.
Clown,
and chased their dreams than those who graduated. Like, look that up. It's a statistic.
It's not a statistic. It's not a statistic. You wouldn't know a statistic if it hit you in the Y equals MX plus B. Jeez, dude. I get so heated when I see this stuff.
Oh, God.
Because it pisses me off. Bad. They're misinforming the people. And then look how he starts this video. I'm so triggered, dude. I really am. This stuff makes me mad.
Yeah, they're awful, dude.
Okay, hold on.
Reminds me of Kevin David. Your boy Kevin David is like this too.
But hold on, listen to this.
So no work.
Watch how he drops. Like, I love this drop. He's going to slide in the DMs with the I'm a millionaire part. Watch this. He's going to go like that.
Express my true thoughts on it on camera because I know it's a controversial, subject. And I know society teaches you a whole different, viewpoint on life. But I hate 9-to-5s. 9-to-5s are legitimately the biggest scam ever ran in the universe. And I
I can't, dude. I'm telling you, it's insane.
I don't understand why people are
just. It's so extreme to say. 9-to-5 scam. No, college is the scam. Everything else, not a scam. Everything? Everything.
Oh, well, yeah, his Forex course, obviously, not a scam. $500 to learn from a multimillionaire? Not a scam, obviously.
Not a scam.
Content and can't grasp that concept. Right, you look at every single thing you do in life as a scam, except a 9-to-5. And I'm here to debunk that. And before I get...
He's going to debunk it with facts and logic. Wow. Like his little college fact. Statistic.
Get into that. If you don't know who I am already, my name is Swaggy C. I'm 25 years old. I live in downtown Los Angeles. I'm a multimillionaire. All that extra stuff. Cool, great, whatever.
Wait. No, not cool, great, whatever. Wait, say that again? He's like, I'm a multimillionaire. Cool, great, whatever. Like, it doesn't matter. Hey, look, guys. Hey, yo, what's up? I'm Coffeezilla. I'm like a rich, super rich billionaire. Like, I'm way more successful than you. Cool, great, whatever. Like, we can just skip over that. It's like, hold up, wait, huh? How'd you get there? And then if you watch his videos, he's like, oh, I just put my mind to Forex. You're like, oh, did you use math? Man, what's Y equals MX plus B? It's like,
he's like, are you one of those pluses and minuses losers? Hey, I'm in Forex.
I just put my mindset to the market. Dude, this is not how... It just makes, look, guys, I'm not trying to hate on him specifically. There's a lot of people with this mentality, right?
Yeah.
It's a mentality of you don't need math, you don't need college, but let's go take on PhDs, master degree students. Let's take on little genius babies at these hedge funds and these firms, and let's take them on in the market. And of course, we'll succeed. Dude, no. What?
Yeah.
Y'all are getting fooled. Y'all are getting fooled by a fool.
No, and the Forex, isn't this just a new day trader? Isn't it just like day trading on like international currencies? Is that how they operate? Like, what do you know about what he teaches? Like,
yeah, he's day trading on Forex, like foreign exchange.
Come on, that is so shaky, dude. We know.
And by the way, Forex is like one of those true zero-sum games, because in order for me to win, you have to lose.
Yeah, your country has to be going to shit. You got to be looking for like which country's going to shit. Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah, no, I mean, anyway, I don't want to get into it too much. I don't want to beat this guy up about it, but like, don't go on and say this is a statistic.
Yeah.
If you dropped out of school and said you never used y equals mx plus b, because statistics is after algebra, buddy. So let's just be clear about it.
Yeah, you kind of need that when you're playing the stock market. Like, you do need math in stocks.
Yo, why is Graham in the title? He's coming on at 4 o'clock, guys. 20 minutes. He's coming on. We're going to roast him. He's going to roast us. It's going to be a fun time.
Oh, I'm going to love him, Stephen. I'm going to say it's gonna I be love
good,
your positivity.
Honestly, it's going to be a good time. Mentality. It's not going to be too hard. We're going to go. Yeah. We're going to have a good time.
You know, there is a clear difference here, though. Like, this guy that you're showing here right now, it is clearly, that is extremely difficult. Anyone who does that and they tell you, like, it's no problem, it's easy, you're doing everything else, scam. I know people who make money doing stuff like this, and it's always unsteady. It's like, I made money for 4 months. It's like gambling. You're gambling. So like, if you're the kind of like, everyone I know is up at the casino, because in your mind, you don't count that all the $100 you lost or all the $500, $1,000 you lost. You just count like, yo man, I just made 10,000. You walk out, you pay every, you give people money. So it makes you like kind of emotionally up and down, I think too. Like, to get into this business that he's talking about, this is a very shaky and very stressful business to get into. Maybe he's got the wherewithal.
He like disparages school like it's dumb to go to school. This is what yeah. I hate. I just hate this disparagement of 9-to-5s and school, because they actually, people believe these idiots, because it is a dumb perspective. Look, when AI is taking over, when you have more technology than ever, turning your back on education is about the dumbest thing you can do for your future. Listen to what he says.
You learn in school. You learn who George Washington is and the Soviet Union and, you know, what's going on in science. Let's talk about Pluto.
Yeah, you should.
Like, let's talk about Pluto, not how I can make some money off the rupee this month. Let's talk about Pluto, not about how the South Korean dollar is going down. It's like, dude,
it's just such a bad mentality to be gambling. Spreading around to people. Yeah.
It's no, 100%. Gambling, man. I mean, okay, if he was saying all that and then he still had a business, maybe, I don't know. But this is like, he's gambling. I mean, Forex trading?
Yeah. 100%. Well, no, he's not gambling because he sells a course and that's how he makes his money. Right. So he's got stable money, but it's because he sells a course to a bunch of idiots who now have unstable income.
Okay, so you know what? Now I think I know what the pipeline is. You start with the thing that they're learning, because even Graham said this in one of his video, where he's like, I have a skill that can make $200,000, let's say, but then if I turn that into a course, it'll make $1 million.
So yeah, it's crazy. It's crazy. It's literally crazy.
Yeah. What's the math on that? Should we ask him that? I do want to ask him that.
Ask Graham the math on courses?
On the math on, like, think about what they're saying. They're basically, like, what he's saying with the course thing, right? And what probably this guy's going to teach you next after you take his Forex course, because it does seem like all these fake gurus, right? Like Ty Lopez, they're ringing you in with course number one. Mm-hmm. And course number one is always get rich, easy, whatever. But after that, it eventually becomes now teach a course. Like,
It's always the ups level is like sell. Now you sell it to other people. But dude, check out this guy's name. By the way, if you want to know who it is, it's the Swag Academy. And by the way, this totally makes me feel bad about my 200K. Because if you can get 200K doing this,
yes, 200K.
I've never done it. I've never.
Did you plan that?
I've done nothing. No, I didn't plan it.
That's so funny. We should put up. Hey guys, we just hit 200K.
I'm finally up to bummed Swag out. Academy. I'm bummed out. We're neck and neck with the Swag Academy, guys. We better not drop behind the Swag Academy. I will lose
Stephen,
faith.
The people who have prosperity on the mind, they grow and they grow. Baby. Why does God give them the favor? God gives them all the favor, and when you tell them, hey, you're doing a scam. God, where's the favor? Where is it? Where's our, you know?
So funny, dude.
Stephen,
so
maybe
funny.
We got to switch businesses here. I mean, you got a whole bunch of suckers here already. No, I'm just kidding. Love you guys.
He got the check too. People are saying he's got the check. Yeah, where's my check, Google?
Where's the check,
Google?
Guys?
Hey, we're gonna do a We're going to do an expose on Google if they don't hurry up.
That's wild. Hey, dude, it was 89K when I started. I remember that. I was like, yo, I did a podcast. This guy has 89K. Bing, bang. It's
yeah, but Zilla has 200K real people. Dude, that's true. That's what I always say. Like, dude, I get more views than Dan Lok. And Dan Lok has like 2 million people. It's because we've got a real community. And it's not about the views. What I'm saying, though, is we have retention because at the end of the day, people are coming for more than like, hey, tell me how to get rich quick. And then they burn out of the pipeline really fast because they're not actually learning anything. Right?
Right.
That's one thing that Graham Stephan has over all these gurus. He retains viewers, showing that people like him actually for him rather than like,
Graham is tight.
You're going to teach me how to get rich quick. He really doesn't do that. He does a lot He does self-help. He does like more personal finance. I wouldn't even say self-help. I'd say like personal finance, real estate stuff. He's and like that's where I think he should stay, by the way. I think he should like stay in that lane. What do you say?
I'm saying he's like an immigrant dad for white people. He's like, hey, don't spend your money, idiot.
Oh, we were talking about this. Yeah. He's got pretty like, it's funny how people succeed telling you what your dad told you. Like, it's like your dad told you, save your money, be smart with your money. You know, spend responsibly, be frugal. But it's like Graham kind of made it cool to be frugal.
Yes. This is the teacher that the culture needs right now. Going into this thing, and which is why I think it's maybe we do got to talk to him about these associations that he has. I don't know if they're all legit. You know, it's fine.
Yeah. We'll just ask. I mean, we're gonna be nice. We're gonna be nice.
But you know, one thing about Swag Academy, real quick. Sorry. To cut you off.
Go ahead.
Swag Academy, dude. Another point about Swag Academy is that I guarantee you he's buying subs. Swag Academy is not the kind of guy that says, "Hey, I won't buy." It's probably in his class. Oh, like in your Forex class or in his like class?
I don't know. I mean, the guy has pretty tight production value. I'll say that. He's actually got one of the best production values of anybody. Yeah. And he's got a funny like his entrance and everything. Hey, people are telling you to turn up, so bring your mic closer.
Oh shit. Sorry.
Hey, relax. This is a PG channel right now, Amish.
Oh,
we're supposed to keep it PG. Look.
Yeah, we're PG, baby.
Hey. Grant, guys, you don't understand. Graham Stephan is Mr. Disney, okay? He's building... Listen, I'm building a brand that no brand will ever want to work with because I call them all scams. Graham Stephan's building a brand where it's like he's going to have Disney coming to him, all this stuff. But you know what? I don't care because that's not my style, you know? We're not trying to, like have Coca-Cola on here. We're trying to have the people. The people are with that.
No, he's about sales, man. I mean, he's a sales guy, you know? And look, I don't know if he wants me to even say this when he's here, but remember I did the joke last time where it's like salespeople, they do this. They're like, hey, if Hitler has a podcast, these salespeople be like, what's the reach though? You know, what's the reach? Might have some buyers, might have some people that might be interested.
Amish.
What's the reach? Why do we got to think in lack? Why we got to think in positivity? And that's the mentality that's taught kind of, you know what I'm saying? That's the mentality that's taught. Is that too much? Are we done? Are we canceled on YouTube? Are we canceled? It's fine. We're going to be so nice. It's fine.
No, it's actually going to be a really good time. I'm looking forward to it. And I told him, listen, I want him to roast me. I want him to tell me what he thinks of my channel and what we do on here, right? Because my guess is he's going to come on here and be like, hey, what are you doing? You're talking about everybody else. Where's your personal finance lessons? And I'm going to go, hey, I'm 26. I don't have any.
Yeah, no, he doesn't believe in that though, dude. He believes in, if he's in truly in sales, trained the way I think he is, because think about it, man. He's so all positive. I don't think he would even come in and start telling you things. He would probably come in and be like, where do you think you could grow? And he'd get you to kind of do it. That's the level of sales that I think he's on. And that's high level sales training.
It's next level. It's all positive.
Like, I don't think he'd come on to you and he'd come on and be like, how do you think I can improve my chain? You know what I mean? Like,
I know he's gonna go. How can I prove my channel? I'm gonna be like, Graham, you have 2 million subs. You tell me.
We can always get closer to God. We can always get closer to God.
Jurgic, one bonk on the head for Amish for calling everyone Hitler. Yeah, bonk. I mean, bonk.
Who's everyone?
No, you do kind of a little bit. Well, you're just quick to snap to like hard hits. But that's what I like about you, Amish. If you were soft on people, I mean, that would be no fun. It's a good time.
The Hitler comparison is just getting out of control, though. It is getting out of control.
It's
like now we just do Alex Jones. Or I don't know. Like you just do someone canceled. You're like, if Alex Jones had it, they.
Oh, dude,
like,
I'd love to listeners. Play our little Alex Jones song right now, but I can't. We're keeping this one PG. We're keeping it PG.
We got to keep it PG. Yeah. I'm excited to talk to him because I do think he's a great guy though. Like he's not this, and Swag Academy, like, is he a 20-year-old who doesn't know yet? Like, I feel like in 2-3 years, Swag Academy could be like, oh my God, I lost everything. He looks so young.
I think he's like more sharp. I think he knows what he's doing. I think he knows that there's a more of a market in teaching than actually doing it. And that actually doing it, there's no money in it.
Wow.
Or very little money in it. And it's just up and down. And so he's like, no, let's just sell out. I think, I don't know. It's just my opinion. Coffeezilla is bigger than Godzilla. Tom S. Dude, thank you, man. Appreciate it. Listen, we're growing it. I want Kevin O'Leary on this podcast next. We got some big guests going on here, and I want to roast Kevin O'Leary on his cameos.
No, but we don't have, like, we're not going to pay for a cameo, Kevin. You come on the show.
Yeah, you come on the show, Kevin, and you pitch our stuff for free, and that's how we do it.
That's how we're going to do it.
We got Roberto Blake, $5. Amish, you gonna do stand up after COVID? Yeah, guys, Amish is a stand up. He's an engineer. He calls everyone Hitler. You've got quite the resume.
Okay, hey, let's not call everyone Hitler. But the other stuff is true. Listen, COVID, it's killing stand up. This is the new stand up, I feel like. I was just talking to a comic who went to LA like a couple weeks ago, and she's telling me like it's dead over there. And then the people who do it, like it is weird. It's getting weird. So I think, this is a shift that the stand-ups needed to make, and COVID is
stand-ups are
like,
all
hey.
Realizing that, yeah, why even do in-person shows? You can reach 200,000 people in one go. Actually, right now we have 900,000 people live, which is wild.
Bing, bang, there
Thanks
you go.
For being
God
here.
Is great.
But you can only reach like 10 people at a comedy club. Why would you go?
Yeah, and if Joan Rivers died with a YouTube channel. She had a YouTube channel when she passed away.
So she knew the wave. She knew the wave was coming.
She's so hardworking, Joan Rivers, dude. She worked her whole life. All the time she worked. She'd take any gig.
She's one of the biggest legends. LA's dead. Legend. Yeah, I agree. $5. Use this $5 for an ad campaign that targets compulsive degenerates and get them to see the scam before they get scammed. Hey, that's Amisha's idea. That's Amisha's idea. Yeah.
We could do that. We could do a crowdfunded ad campaign.
A crowdfunded ad campaign that only targets Dan Locke. Only targets Dan Locke videos. And it's like, hey, guys, I know you want to make money. I know it. Hey, it's okay. Like, come into the fold. Listen, here at Coffeezilla, we all still want to make money, but we're going to do it ethically. We're going to do it in a way that actually makes sense. You're not going to quit your job. You're going to go build a real skill. And that's, I think people would join, honestly. I think people would see that and be like, this guy, he's speaking
What's wrong,
the truth.
Dude? Yeah, no, dude. Man, I was pitching it to you last week.
I was roasting you about it last
week. We'll do them. I've already started writing these ads. We got to do the ads, dude.
Drink a Starbucks coffee during the Graham interview. Actually, I've got my coffee already ready for Graham, but yeah.
Oh, nice.
Absolutely. We got 10 minutes to Graham. 10 minutes to Graham, guys.
10 minutes to Graham time, baby.
But it's a pregame, guys. It's a pregame, and it's a celebration of you at home. You guys got us here. You got me here. 200K subs. 2.5K on the drip. Which we got to pump those numbers up, okay?
We got to pump those numbers up. Be honest. But dude, 200K is very exciting. We got someone on who has coming on today who has 2.5 million. Like he's up in that range, I feel like. Or no, 4.5 million.
He's got 4.5 million?
I don't know. I got to check. His second channel is huge, too. He has two huge channels. He's killing it, dude.
2.57 million.
Oh, my God. This guy's coming in 10 minutes. We're like, how many subs does he have?
I got to ask Graham how you make every video 10 minutes. I make these videos and I'm like, I cannot think of a way to make this 10 minutes.
Guarantee he has a formula. Guarantee he has a formula.
Yeah, because for me, I'll make it and I just make it like, I think of making as short as it needs to be, but I see all these YouTubers, they make it as long as it possibly needs to be. And it's like, I don't know. At first I thought the audience didn't like that. You guys tell me if you like that. But then I saw some people, they go, oh, this video's too short. Like they've been conditioned that if I don't talk to them for 10 minutes, they're not happy. So maybe, and the algorithm loves it too. So like, do y'all want me to just rant at y'all for 10 minutes? I feel like uploading a 4-hour podcast every week is probably enough though.
Yeah, no, that's enough. That's one format. But Alex Becker's class teaches like a 8 to 10 minute format. He's got a format. Alex Becker, he does like, you intro with this, you do these, you do 3 points per video. It's a great system. I think Graham might use the same system.
People want to know what type of engineers are y'all? Amish?
I'm aerospace because you know I like to go right up to God. I'm trying to fly right up there.
I'm Kim. Wow. First of all, very good. Very good. I did chemical engineering because I like to get a reaction from the crowd.
Oh, woo.
Oh, never mind. I thought I was going to get a better reaction than that. Thanks a lot, live audience. We have a live audience, and sometimes they're not kind to me. Hey, can you stop that cricket
noise?
We
got $5 right when you said that. I don't know what you mean. I think this person said they heard the joke. They said, give him $5.
Hey.
You said that joke. You said I like to get a reaction, and he goes, give him $5. Let's go. And this person was ready with it. What does it say?
Loves your vids, Coffeezilla. I'm at 11K and hope to be at 200K subs one day. Cross your finger. Listen, to get to 200K subs, let me give you advice that is probably not true. You got to believe in something. It doesn't matter what it is, but you got to have a message to your channel. Have something to say, right?
Yeah. And
I see a lot of channels and I'm like, wait, why do you have a channel? You don't have anything to say. Like they just want to have big channels. I'm not saying you're like that, by the way. But some channels that I see, I'm like, oh, you don't have a point. 15 minutes is ideal. Oh, people are saying 15 minutes. No, don't be long. We need longer. Yeah, it's kind of confusing. Some people like it, some people don't. Huh.
You almost got to say, you got to let go and let God. You got to just do it till the feeling's right and say, that's what God wants. That's how much God wants.
Is this what I'm going to get in your digital ashram when I join?
In my digital ashram, dude. We got the location. It's great. It's right on the Electron. It's great. But what does Alex Miller say? Terrible joke. Hey, watch your mouth!
Alex Miller, you better pipe down before we drag you in here. We'll drag you in here and we'll make you confess. That in front of the people.
Yeah, exactly. Eh?
Listen. Hey, we
keep
better
it positive.
Keep it positive for Graham. Keep it PG for Graham, guys. Come on.
Imagine we kicked him out. I know some people that would kick people out over that. What a lame look, eh? I remember I was at a comedy show and they kicked this guy out because he said something and they're like, oh, kick him out. It's harassing. It's like, hey.
Oh, come on.
Let him say his shit, man.
Yeah, we're going to let y'all talk. The only thing we don't like is when people spam because that just bothers everybody. But like, if y'all want to, y'all hit us with the heat, guys. Hit us with the heat.
Hit us with the heat. And if y'all have $5, we'll spam it too then.
Kiwi, five pounds. You guys are deltas in the fake alpha world. Keep up the good work. I don't know what that means, but I assume it's nice. Thank you, man.
Hey, delta sounds nice, dude. It's a triangle. It's upward.
We got 7 minutes. T-minus 7 minutes to Graham Stephan.
Graham Stephan. Until we get that favor. Wow, he looks great. He looks like Tom Cruise.
Doesn't he? Little bit of a stretch, no?
No,
maybe a little bit.
Or maybe he just reminds me the energy, like the positivity, the energy. He's always
smiling. I actually started thinking we looked a lot alike. So I'm not insulting Graham. I'm insulting both of us. Look, yeah. No, okay, you forgot what Tom Cruise looked like. Come on, let's be real.
It's the vibe and everything. It just gives me a Tom Cruise feel. He gives me a Tom Cruise vibe.
No. I'm sorry. You gotta have that jawline. You gotta have the jawline, right? Why are we even talking? This is the dumbest conversation.
He's coming in 5 minutes. Just don't say he doesn't have a jawline, too. Oh,
no, I'm not.
God,
he does
Graham.
Have a jawline. I'm saying you said Tom Cruise, okay? Relax.
Look, it's the overall vibe. It's like that. It's like he's representing that kind of upbeat positivity.
Listen, as Alex Jones would say, my superpower is being honest, okay? It's my superpower.
That's it. You can't help it. You can't help it.
I can't help saying what
say
I feel.
Say what you say.
The bigger channels are aiming for 10-minute average view duration. You'll notice they are making 16-minute-plus videos. I know, but sell out at what cost, you know? Because I honestly don't have things to say for 16 minutes. Maybe I'll just speak slower.
Is that selling it out?
No, it's not. It's fine.
Just do what feels right. You know, like you have a point to a video, and when that point is complete, that's when the video ends, right?
Yeah.
That's what I mean by the God
most of the time, I mean, maybe I have the soul of wit, but most of the time my videos are short. Like, I mean, I just finish my point, and then I'm like, oh, wait, that's it. I'm joking, by the way. Nick Vizor, thank you for being the voice of truth. I've listened to Coffeezilla all day at work for over a week now. Thanks for making the vids audio friendly. Of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Hey. I don't know a single person who doesn't make their vids audio friendly, but I'll take the compliment. Thank you very much. Coffee, your
YouTube
name should be Amish on account of your suspenders and creamy shirt. Hey, we should call it Amish and Amish. The podcast.
Amish and Amish. Oh, you're Amish. And yeah. You're Amish. He's saying you're Amish.
That's
was that $100? 100 rupees? No, 100.
100 something. These currencies come in. I don't know what they are.
The currencies, we're getting hundreds.
I feel
y'all.
So
we're
uneducated.
Hundreds.
So uneducated.
Look at that favor.
Go
look
ahead.
That,
go ahead. Go ahead. Read that off real quick.
Is that? Hey, Coffeezilla, would like to connect with you regarding information on some important fake guru cases from India. Hit me up if you're interested. Yo, email us. We would love to hear about the Indian, how they're hitting the Indian subcontinent. Actually, I think Anand told me he started in India. is called stuff. There's a guy in India who basically teaches all the Dan Lok classes. He just he just translates it and he just teaches it himself. He might have, I think he goes, gives him a shout out, but then he has like, he's India's Dan Lok. Or not.
No, like, showed you this. No, he's actually copying him. He's just copying him.
He's just copying him.
No, he's not. He's not like giving him credit. No, he's just stealing from Dan Lok.
There's also a guy named
Philip Solo TV. Dude, I'm a big fan of this guy. I'm actually a big fan of Philip Solo TV. Hey, thanks for coming by. Oh, he says, thanks for having Always Marco on the on, guys. Love the channel. Always Marco is always welcome on our podcast. We love Always Marco. But Philip, we got to have you on sometime too. I saw your video about the show and or about your like YouTube channel and all that kind of stuff. And he was talking about views being down or up and how it affected his like mood. I felt that. So we should talk about that sometime.
Dude, it's have you seen Lindsay Ellis's video about how this is like emotional labor, basically? It's a little lefty for you, maybe, but she makes some good points. It's a little on the left, but she makes some points about emotional labor and just like YouTubers burning out and getting weird and stuff like that.
I just feel like YouTubers, we are given too much information by, hold on 1 second. I'm sorry. I got to ban this guy.
Uh-oh. Who doesn't have respect?
Sorry, guys. Okay. What was I saying? I was talking about...
You were saying YouTube. YouTube coming up. Wow, this guy had to get banned. Wait, what have we got? We got your boy. Your boy just messaged us. Philip Solo TV.
Yeah. So I feel like YouTubers are given too much information in like the dashboard. And they're like, every video, let me tell you how it feels to upload a video. Every video, in 30 minutes, you know how bad your video is in ranks of 10. That's too much information. Back in the day, when an artist painted on the canvas, he didn't know within 30 minutes how good it was because it'd be debilitating. You're constantly up and down and you're like, it forces you to go with the trends more, which I don't like. I want to write a script for all YouTubers. I don't feel like anyone would do it, but I want to do it where it's hidden from me. I don't even know what my, like, I want to know the metrics. I want to know how long people watch. I want to know that kind of stuff. But like where it ranks and all that like kind of comparative stuff, it's bad for my bad vibes. Very bad vibes,
man. I mean, so this morning, not to brag, I hate when I do this, but I got
Graham canceled because you roasted him. No, he didn't.
No, he's not canceled. He's here.
Roast him.
We didn't even roast him. We love Graham.
No, that's not true.
It's fine. No, but some art takes time, man. And I mean, they're just constantly telling you like, adjust this, fix this, whatever. We were talking about. Do you know Noah Keegan? Noah Keegan. He's a bit of it's almost like I want to call them algorithm robots. Noah Keegan, I feel like he's a bit of an algorithm robot. Like, he's doing everything by the book on his channel. And I'm just like,
it's not good. It's not good. Listen, you don't build real communities with that. Like, I was looking at these guys, Nelk. Have you ever heard of Nelk on YouTube?
Yeah, they're Canadian, no?
They're killing it right now. But here's why they're killing it. They're not going with, like, the YouTube algorithm of family-friendly. They went, like, hard, basically rated R stuff. Yeah. They always get age restricted. They get videos removed all the time. Like, whatever. But they're so rock and roll that they have 6 million followers, but they'll get like 7 million views on a video because they're popping. They're doing a collab with Dana White. Like, they're like just true YouTubers. Yeah. Just forget about the metrics. Screw like what YouTube wants you to do and go be rock and roll, dude. That's what people want to see though, right? Like, I don't want to see some YouTuber like hunched over the analytics. Oh my God, my YouTube video didn't do well. It's like, forget about it. Just go live your dream. We're all living our dreams, baby.
Yeah.
Graham, dude, where's Graham at? Oh, he's probably like right on time. I told him like 1 minute from now, he's probably going to join in exactly 1 minute. I feel like that's the kind
Graham
of person
is very
he is.
Classy and very hardworking. He's not, he's just going to show up like exactly on time.
He's going to finish the work he was doing like in 30 seconds. And then he'll be like, okay, and join in.
He's probably telling someone like, I actually have a schedule. I'm scheduled on a YouTube call right now, so I got to go. And he's going to walk away from some $1 million clients. I mean, he's selling big real estate too. So...
Oh, here we go. All right.
Oh, he's here.
Yeah, what's up? Hold on. Let's get this set up, boys. Whoa. Sorry.
Yeah, what's up? Hold on.
Let's get this set up. All right, we got a little bit of a headphone problem. We need those headphones in. Hearing some echo.
Oh, wait. How do we?
All right, we got a little bit of a
headphone problem.
Oh, wait. Hold on, guys.
Oh, do you need headset?
We're working on it, gentlemen. Hold on.
Man, he's got a team, man.
I'll just mute you real quick while you get that set up. And guys, it's coming.
Yeah.
Don't worry, it's guys. It's coming.
The gram is coming. You're getting your gram.
Lance Anthony, Graham Stephan has...
Wait, unmute. Start my video. Hold on.
Oh, there he is. Okay. You good?
All right. I'm down here. Got better Wi-Fi down here.
Okay, sick. Sweet. Okay. All right, you good? Oh, let's get you in here. Boom. What's up, Graham? Hey, how you doing?
This is so weird to see myself like on screen. Like,
yeah. What's up, dude?
Hey.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks for coming. Give yourself a round of applause. Okay, this has been a long time coming. You know it has. We've been talking offline for a little bit, and it's just been a while in the making. Guys, put ones in chat for Graham. Got a million viewers right now, live right now. So
the Indian community loves you, by the way. The Indian community loves you. Points on being cheap, they say, wow, this guy's, he's better than us. They love it, dude. They love the tip.
He's saying, finally, somebody says it. Finally, a white guy says it.
Finally, someone's teaching them. They'll fall behind. You know, that's what my uncle's been saying.
And I got my coffee.
There you go.
Is this the 50 cent iced coffee I keep hearing about?
50 cents? What are you talking? It's 20 cents.
How? And why, by the way, Graham? Is it a point you're making at this point? Or is it just like, you just think, oh, it's not going to get better coffee than this, so I'm just going to keep this coffee.
What? Yeah, it's about saving the money. Honestly, I think it's a waste to go and pay like $4 or $5 for a coffee. And at this point, honestly, I think I make better coffee than Starbucks does. Plus, they have this on sale. It's Pete's Coffee, the grocery store. It's anywhere from like $5 to $10 for a bag. It makes, I don't know, 50 cups of coffee. It's a lot.
So you know what I did now is I just bought full beans. I grind them at home, put them in water, and I cold brew it. It's the cheapest way possible, I think, because they're not even, I'm not even letting, because they'll probably charge me a commission on grinding it for me. There's probably a little bit, someone's making a cut on grinding the beans.
Believe it or not, it depends on the coffee you buy, but a lot of the time it's the same price between ground coffee and non-ground coffee.
That's what I'm
saying. It's pretty much the same price. Some people argue you could get a fresher taste by grinding the beans yourself, but I don't find there to be that big of a difference.
Good tip, man. I think I'm going to get ground from now on. I think I'm going to get ground from now on. I don't know why I assumed that.
No, yeah. Well, just check the prices.
I'm wearing down my blade.
Hey, you know the secret, Amish, is the price per ounce. That's actually how you be a true cheapskate. It's like, don't worry about price. Worry about price per ounce, and that's actually how you know if you're getting a good deal or not.
Penny-wise and pound foolish, not cheapskate.
And this is something, too. I'm actually in the process now of trying to start up my own coffee company.
Really? Graham. Where's the call? Where's the call? I can't endorse this coffee product until I get a call about
the
me.
Sheriff has to get a taste.
How about this? I will send you. I'll send you a bag for free. You just got to be completely honest with your review. If you hate
No. I'm talking about a cut, Graham. Give me a little cut.
You're in the business.
If we're gonna introduce it to the Coffeezilla Army, you got to get a little cut of the coffee brand. What are you gonna call it? You got a name?
Right now, it's going to be Brew Culture.
Right. And I'm sure there's an affiliate program. Classy. There's got to be an affiliate program, no?
Probably an affiliate.
No. I was going to just start making ads.
Okay, so let's get into it. We have a bunch of questions. Do you have a hard out at three? Okay. Yeah. All right. Let's just jump into these questions then. All right. Cool. So first of all, I watched one of your videos when you said that you were inspired by this guy, Rob Dom.
Yeah.
Can you tell me who that is and what that means to you? Let's get deep on who That's Graham Stephan is. Who does Graham That's Stephan look guru. Up to?
Yeah. Rob Dom was the one that got me into wanting to make YouTube videos. He posted something. It was like 2011, I think it was. How he bought a Lamborghini Diablo. And this is before like Ty Lopez had his Lamborghinis. This is before like the Lamborghini was like an e-commerce thing. This guy, Rob Dom, had a Lamborghini Diablo.
It was still cool. I feel like Lambos have been kind of tainted. The brand has been devalued, actually. It's unfortunate.
Unfortunately, I would agree with that. I think now, if I were to get a Lambo, it would be this like, oh, why is Graham getting a Lamborghini? It's bad. But back then, Rob Dom had this Lamborghini Diablo, and I watched this full video from him where he explained how he was able to afford a car. And he made this video in response to this guy, Robert Hilmer or something. I forget the name. But he was trying to sell some sort of book that was basically a repackaged Think and Grow Rich. Okay. So Rob Dom came out there and said, guys, you don't need to buy this book. Here's how you could buy a Lamborghini Diablo. Here's how I did it. And that video for me was so inspirational that I just decided, like, this is like, there's a huge market for this. Like, if this got me so hyped, yeah, that was it.
That's the guy.
And he filmed it in his garage.
I do my research, Graham. I do my research. Yeah. You better believe it. Don't be too surprised. Okay.
It sounds like Tom Vu. Remember the Asian guy selling the real estate class, and he has all the girls with bikinis. Like, is it different than
that? Oh my God, those are hilarious.
Yeah, those are
I love those infomercials.
Those make me lose my mind. So Rob Dom got you started. But one thing I want to talk to people about, because you're kind of like Mr. Motivational, Mr. Positivity. That's kind of like a lot of your brand,
prosperity.
Right?
Prosperity. There's a lot of prosperity.
So tell me, you almost didn't start on YouTube because you had somebody basically say, don't do it, Graham. It's a waste of time. Yeah. You need so much money to start. What would you tell people who are gonna who are looking to start a YouTube channel? Just don't listen to the naysayers or what? I mean, because sometimes they're right. Yeah. Like, you are a case of survivorship bias where, like, you won the game, but that's not always true, right?
I don't think it's necessarily like someone's winning or you can't win or it's impossible to win, because I honestly
stop.
Wait.
Yeah. Let's be clear, yeah. Graham. Okay. You're winning. And it's easy to say it as a winner, to say, oh yeah, who's winning? I saw saying that, like, it was Robert Herjavec from the Shark Tank. They're like, mm-hmm. Oh, so you're winning. Does that mean, like, you know, you're super successful? Like, what about all these other people who are losers? And he goes, oh no. I wouldn't call them losers. And it's like, wait, but they, like, compared to you, they are.
Steven, God is abundant.
Yes, but you shouldn't be comparing yourself to somebody else in the sense that, like, if you're not at my level, then you're not winning.
Right. But what I'm saying is, what's your advice for people who
start? I mean, that is a win.
Yeah. If you want to start a YouTube channel, if people want to start a YouTube channel for a full-time job, if they're not thinking, like, I want to create content, I always encourage people to create content, do all that stuff. What about when people come to you and they say, hey, I want to do this full-time like you, Graham. I want to be just as big as you.
I immediately tell them, you need to do it because you love making videos. Because otherwise, if you don't like making videos and you wouldn't do it for free, there's no way you're going to be able to push past the point that you need to begin making money. Like, I'll give you an example. There's a guy that I met about a year and a half ago, Ennis, and he does property tours. And he started making these property tours for fun as a way to build up business as a real estate agent. And his channel ended up taking off, and he got in this really good niche. He started making really good content, and now he almost does it full time now. But he would have never gotten to that point if he went into it thinking, all right, I'm just going to make a whole bunch of money doing a YouTube channel. That's probably the biggest issue that I see with people, is that they just see, like, wow, he's making all this money. Let me just go and start a YouTube channel. And it's easy. He just flips on the camera and just talks. Ugh. But there's so much involved behind it. Like, I started making videos because I loved it. I had so much fun. Rob Dom, like I said, was the one that inspired me. Like, I figured if I got that hyped up, imagine the impact that I would be able to have on other people by sharing my own story. But I did that just without the expectation of making any money from it. It was just, I loved it. I would come home, I would work on YouTube from like 7 p.m. to like 2 o'clock in the morning. I had so much fun with it.
When did you seriously start doing YouTube?
I would say January 2017 is when I set a goal for myself that, like, I'm going to post 2 to 3 times a week. And I've stuck with that schedule. And then I would say about a year and a half ago was the point where it started to take off, to the point where I was like, I can't ignore this any longer. And I have this little window of opportunity where if I don't double down at this point, I'm not sure when I'm going to have this opportunity again. So I may as well take it. And I had so much fun doing it.
Yeah, because at that point you're still a real estate agent, but I think probably most of your focus has shifted over to the YouTube side, right?
Yeah. And
does that mean
honestly,
clients?
At this point, it's like 90, I'd say probably 90% YouTube at this point, 10% real estate. But the real estate I do at this point really is for myself.
Mm-hmm. And does YouTube not get you some clients? Like, do you not get?
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
Oh, geez. In the beginning, it got me nothing. In the beginning, I went into it thinking, oh, wow, maybe I could get like a deal or two from it. And I did. But it was never to the point that actually made it worth it for my time as a real estate agent. At this point, I probably get leads like every few days, and I pass them over to other people in the office, and they take care of them.
Wow, that, there's so much abundance. You pass on the leads. That's great. I mean, that's how all these reality TV shows are funded. I mean, they don't even pay on TV, the reality shows, when they have those like flip your property, whatever. They don't pay anyone, but these real estate agents come out and they're like, I'm the king of my small town now because I'm on the TV show or whatever. So
yeah, that's totally how it is. Winner takes all. Let's talk about, I want to talk to you about Meet Kevin. Okay. Little backstory.
Okay.
Me and Kevin, we're not best friends. We don't text all the time. I have his number, but we chat every now and then. But people don't know, I have a true soft spot in my heart for Meet Kevin because he saved my butt. Back in the day.
With the insurance.
Early on, Meet Kevin was like, he was doing the like roasting thing for pretty early on. And he got sued by Grant Cardone. A lot of people don't know this. Maybe some people do. The people who've been watching a while know this. But he called me. I remember I didn't like really know him. I didn't really, whatever. And he sent me a DM. He goes, hey, let me save you. And it was a lot of money. He told me basically how much he spent on the lawsuits. He goes, let me save you this amount of money. You have to have liability insurance. And right after that, I was just starting to kind of like get an audience because I was just doing it because I was so annoyed by the business gurus and the lies and the false claims. So I just started doing it. I was starting to get enough attention to where I was starting to become a bit of a problem for the gurus that I was talking about. And I got it at the perfect time. And that's right when all the cease and desist letters rolled in and all that kind of stuff happened. So I've been forever grateful to him. But what's your story with Meet Kevin? When did you meet him? What's y'all's relationship like?
Yeah, we met. Gosh, he sent me an email shortly after I started making YouTube videos. I think I maybe had like 7,000 subscribers.
Oh.
Kevin reached out to me, sent me an email, and basically said we had all of this in common. He wrote this whole like 2-3 paragraphs. Yeah. And at the bottom of it, he said like, hey, I think we should connect. So I gave him a call one night and we probably talked for like an hour. I kid you not. It was like, as soon as I called him, it was as though he was like this long lost friend. You know when you haven't seen somebody for a long time and you just like pick right back up? It was like that for someone I've never met, and that was Kevin. He wanted to do a video together, and I think I just got busy, so it just didn't happen. And then a month later, he came out with this video titled, What Graham Stephan Isn't Telling You. And I remember seeing this video where he was coming out of bushes and stuff like that, and what I wasn't telling people was that you could buy real estate with 3% down. I was telling people, put 20% down. Kevin was like, no, 3% down. Just get in the game. And that's what I wasn't telling people. I thought it was an odd video, I'll be honest. Kevin knows this.
He came at you hard. He came at you hard. Cutthroat.
And it's in the kids' children's park, isn't it? Isn't it like a little kids' park?
Yeah. He's coming down a slide in one of the scenes. He's on the side of a freeway.
Yeah.
He's coming out of a bush. It was funny, just like... Man. And then it made me rethink, like, wait a second. Who is this guy? Who did I talk to? Like, what did I agree to get myself into?
Yeah.
And I didn't think much of it. And then the video started taking off. And he had no subscribers. I think he had maybe like 100 subscribers.
Mm-hmm.
That video started racking up tens of thousands of views. And what happened was that when people would Google my name, it would show up the first thing for me as a real estate agent, what Graham Stephan isn't telling you. And now all of a sudden I'm like, oh crap, like this has the power to impact my business. Because if someone is looking me up to use me as a real estate agent, they type in Graham Stephan, real estate agent, what Graham Stephan isn't telling you, they're not gonna watch
it
the video.
It started with the beef. I can't believe it.
He's like your nemesis. He's
well,
like,
no,
he's
not
like,
anymore though.
The
now
YouTube
they're
game.
Friends, I think.
Yeah.
We're really good friends now. But anyway, after that, I reached back out to him. I'm like, listen, man, maybe we could work something. You got to change the title, but how about that? Let's meet up. And we ended up meeting up and instantly since then, best friends.
Wow. So you reached across the aisle. You didn't send a cease and desist letter. You just sent him a little something. You know, actually, the first time probably, I mean, I made a video about you, about how you're wrong. I said what Graham Stephan's wrong about fake gurus. So I kind of did the Meet Kevin thing. What did you think about that video? Because I would say, actually, it's funny. We agree on a lot. I'll just tell the people. Because I don't talk too much about personal finance because I feel like that's not my niche. But my mentality is very similar to yours. Of be frugal. Be smart with your money. Don't go crazy. Don't go gamble it. Don't be stupid. Just like common sense personal finance tips.
People need that.
Yeah, they, well, no,
they're
people
bad with money. Well, everyone
and a lot of people are not teaching those like basics. So I like a lot of the stuff you're putting out there. But you and I disagree on courses, right? You sell a course. You know, I roast courses. That's like what my thing. Okay, give us your opinion of courses, and then like, when does it become predatory? Because would you agree that there's a lot of courses out there that are predatory, or would you disagree with that?
100%.
Okay.
I think it would be impossible to disagree with that. 100%. So here's my take on courses, because initially I went into YouTube hating on anyone who sold any amount of information whatsoever.
Yeah.
Right.
That's there. I mean, and okay. I'll wholeheartedly come out and say that I have changed my mindset on it.
Sure.
I had never sold any information before. I had no idea what to expect. I went into it with a very negative mindset of just like everyone that sold courses, they're trying to abuse it. But when you really get down to it, what changed my mind was that in the beginning, I had so many people reaching out for like consultations. Starting off with that, how could I grow my career as a real estate agent? Let me know what I could do to be coached by you. And I don't have the time to do this. So I started telling people, okay, how about this? It's $100 for an hour. Let's go over your business and let's do this.
The community demanded it. They said, please, please, we need you. And you said, okay, I'm going to be your guru then. Fine.
Yeah.
Fine.
I know that's, listen, I know that sounds to you like it's one of these like salesy things. But when you go through my email, I mean, there are people willing to pay thousands of dollars that I turned down just for the opportunity to go to dinner or just meet up. And I know to you, it sounds like this crazy thing.
No,
but,
no, that happens, man.
But I have paid for mentorship myself. I have used coaching myself. Ah. I have done this and I see the benefit of it. So for me, it just, from a scalability factor, I mean, it makes sense to go and create a program like this for the people who want it. I don't push it down people's throats. I don't act like there's some, you know, master class that's going to be ending in 5 minutes. It's there. If people want it, they could use it. If they want something more advanced than what I offer for free on the YouTube channel, they can.
Do you use a ticker on the sales page? Like if I go to your sales page, will it say like Debbie in Toronto bought it?
No.
Nandita in boom, Mumbai just bought a family pack.
So you basically think it's like comes down to the advertising. You're like when they advertise too hard. What about, so my
here's,
kind
here's,
of-
Here's what I really think it comes down to. Here's right. My honest thought sure. is that if the person gets the value from the course plus more or the program, mm-hmm. then I think it's worth it.
Yeah.
If you're paying, let's say $200, but you are receiving back $300 worth of value, I would say that's good money spent. If you're spending $1,000 on something and in return you get nothing back, I would say that's a pretty bad deal. For mine, I price it in line with where I think it's worth, knowing that no one who buys it would be unhappy with it. If they are, they get a full refund within 30 days. That's one of the reasons why I think I haven't seen a single negative thing about my program ever. And you know, I don't suppress information. Someone can post a video on me if they want to. They can say whatever they want. I have yet to see a single person say, I bought this program. It sucks. He ripped me off. He scammed me. Nothing in almost 3 years. And I attribute that to pricing it where I think it should be valued. If someone does mm-hmm. have a problem with it, that's fine. I totally get it. It's not for everyone. Sometimes people go into it and say, you know what? Watch the whole thing. It's not for me. I don't want to make YouTube videos. Hey, you know what? I don't really need the information. Can I get a refund? That's fine. So I think as long as you go into it with proper customer service and just acknowledging that, like, hey, it's not for everyone. If they buy it and a week later they regret it, so be it. That's
right.
Fine. But I think that long-term mindset of just going in and like, hey, I think it's a good deal. I think you'll like it. If not, that's totally fine. That is what I think is going to work best long-term. Some people I think are terrible at it. Some people just go in and they just want to make as much money as they can in the first like 6 months. They don't care what people say about them. If they say negative things, doesn't matter to them. To me, it really affects me. If anyone has anything negative to say about me, I really take it to heart. I really look internally like, what did I do wrong? How can I improve? And what can I do better? And how can I make this right?
Okay, so speaking of a big thing that my community was reaching out about is you had some past collabs with Kevin David, Dan Locke. Have you changed your mind on these guys that you used to collab with early on in your career? More information has come out about them. What's your current opinion on these guys who, for me, gigantic scammer. I'll say it any day of the week. These guys are scamming people out of their hard-earned money. It's not right. Kevin David plagiarizes information from people. He rips it off and pretends it's his own. He tells people they're going to make $500 a day by typing on a keyboard. Like, it's just, it's silly. It's silly. What do you think?
I'm definitely a lot more careful about who I have on the channel now. And especially back then, I think people have changed in ways that I don't necessarily agree with. So I'm more careful now about who I associate with, where back then it was really all about providing different perspectives and different information. And for me, I learn from everybody. Regardless of what people might think of them, I think there is value to be had in looking at what they're doing and seeing and how they operate. Now I'm definitely a lot more careful about it.
Right. What a very political answer. Great. Graham, give me, Great. You so are right. Mr. Positivity, and I love it about you, but at the same time, because I feel like maybe we're a bit of like yin and yang a little bit, right? Like a little bit of a yin and yang thing. But I want you to say, is there anybody in the personal finance community that you're kind of like, can you say anything negative about anybody? Or are you just positive about everybody?
What, you're forcing him to say something negative about
someone?
No,
I mean, is it? What do you think of Dan Bilzerian? Let me give you an easy one.
How about this? I will say.
Okay.
I think anyone who flat out copies videos, I've had my videos copied. Straight up, titles, thumbnails, exact jokes in videos. I disagree with that. I don't think that means everything they're doing is bad, but I do completely agree that, like,
this is the closest thing to getting cussed out by Graham Stephan you will ever find.
That's good, dude.
He will never do it.
You could run for office. You could run for office, dude.
Yeah, this is like smooth, though. I honestly wonder when the presidential candidacy is, because these are some great answers.
You don't need to say something negative about someone. Why it doesn't hurt? It doesn't help you. And I get that. It is like a bit of sales mentality. So, like, let me ask you this though: Have you done a lot of classes? Because I am recognizing some moves. Like, one of my favorites that I've seen, and you do it too, and it's like, at what point do you go like, hey, you got to do some sales shit, or sorry, some sales stuff, sorry, and then you got to keep it like whatever. Like, one of the things that you were saying on your video, I've just heard a lot of people say it, I'm not saying that you plagiarized it, maybe you came to it on your own, but one of the things was that move where you're like, hey, if I don't make them pay for it, they don't appreciate it. I got to make you pay. You pay, then you get here on time, you do it right, then that's good
true.
For you.
It's true. If you pay for something, you value it more. 100%. If you have nothing invested, you are less likely to follow through. I make sure, at least if I'm going to charge something, it's going to be worth it to them. If not, so be it. And I never force anyone to buy it. I never make them feel like, if you don't buy it now, you're going to be a failure the rest of your life. No. And I will tell you one experience that I had that was a big wake-up call for me is I had someone begging me for a discount in one of my coaching. It's like, and this is back when I was doing those hour-long coaching calls.
Sure.
And they were begging me to do a discount. I think back, I was charging like $450 for an hour. And they said, all I have is like $200. Would you please do it? And I said, fine. You know what? I would do it. And I think we scheduled the call for like 9 o'clock in the morning, something like this. Yeah. And 9 o'clock, I call him, doesn't pick up his phone. And like when I do these calls, by the way, I will actually like schedule that out of my day. Like I will stop what I'm doing. Same with this. Like I was planning a video, I will stop exactly at the minute and I try to block that in and respect people's time. So I'm always on time. But sure enough, nothing. And I call back 5 minutes later, nothing. Call back 5 minutes later, nothing. And then around like 9:12, 9:13, calls back, he had overslept. So I guarantee that wouldn't have happened if he had more money on the line to the point where it's like, it actually stinks. Where it really incentivized him not to sleep in. And I won't go into specifics for my own situation, but I've paid other people too. And I will say, I've paid people for advice that I know is out there for free. I acknowledge it. But I will tell you that I listen to it because I have money on the line. and I'm more likely to follow it because I'm like, oh crap, I just paid $250 for this, and I'm gonna follow it. And just because of the follow through, it makes it more worthwhile.
But you know, you're tight with your money, and that almost informs everything. It's almost like even with the coffee, it's like right now you're doing a 50 cent, but once you start selling it, you're like, I'm making money on a coffee. When I drink a coffee, I make $2. You know what I mean?
No, the point of selling coffee, it's going to be the same price. The right. point is building out a different income source in the future at some point, or finding some different way to deviate from that. But I'm not trying to sell 20 cent coffee for 50 cents.
Actually, my mentality on education is sort of with the mentality probably that you have on coffee, which I'm like, why would you pay for something that's out there for free? And then here's how I think about it. Because I was talking to Misha about this. Before Google, and this is where, I mean, I understand there are different perspectives on this. Some people want to go to Starbucks. They want the Starbucks latte or premium. Whatever. But I think it's, I personally think it's ridiculous, and I'll just say that forever. But how I feel about information is, it used to be like before Google, when you took a course, you could get something that truly did not exist in the public domain. You know what I mean? And like Google's democratized information, everyone knows that. So the true value of a course is the time it saves you from looking it up yourself, if that makes sense, right? That's a good way to think about the value of a course, is it saves you like, I don't know, 5 hours of researching. But some of these courses, like, it started to make me think that a $2,000 course could almost never be worth it by definition. Because if, let's say you're making 10 bucks an hour at Kohl's, right? Actually, the less money you make, the more courses are not worth it, because it's more of your time that you have to work to afford it. So if you're working at Kohl's for 10 bucks an hour and you buy a $2,000 course, you're spending 200 hours to take a course of your time, 200 effective hours of your time. And my thought is, you can always learn more by just investing that time into learning it yourself. I think there is a mentality, it's a bit of a like a high school mentality of just feed me the information. I feel like a lot of people, they really come to gurus because they don't want to learn it themselves, because they want someone to do the work, but the work cannot be done. A trainer cannot lift the weights for you. Somebody can't, obviously people still spend it. I don't understand it, but like, eventually you just have to do the work. And I feel like that's my message to people, is go learn how to learn, and then you never have to have anyone again, right? Like, that's like the ultimate thing to become self-sufficient, right? Like, what do you think about that?
You're going to start a learn how to learn class, Steven? We're going to get that class,
hey,
dude?
Hey, maybe I'll become like Graham. Like, in a way, I could become like Graham eventually. Change my mind, start a course for you guys.
But it's a great point that Graham's making, man. If people are asking, you're literally saying, no, I'm not going to give you something. Like, they want the course sometimes. Not course, but like they want, but in his case.
But I feel like you're setting people's expectations wrong if you tell them that I can actually help you. Because I don't believe that I can actually help people. Like, for example, on YouTube, I think the only way to learn YouTube is to do YouTube. I don't think that you can like give them hacks. I don't believe in like, I mean, above the obvious stuff you learn in the first 20 minutes of researching YouTube. The only way to get better is by doing it. You would not be the YouTuber you are by taking a class. You have to do it.
Here's the thing. I would disagree, because I have learned some ways to grow on YouTube from other YouTubers. I have talked with other people and seen, wow, this is working for you. Okay, let me try this on my end. And it works really well. I know for a fact I've helped other YouTube channels grow considerably and double or triple the size, or make significantly more money with a few simple things that you can't learn some of these things on your own. Even during my entire experience, a lot of my growth has come from talking with other YouTubers. Just as I'm sure you and I will talk about the YouTube algorithm at some point. I know for a fact, whatever my suggestions might be could end up significantly helping your channel. And I'm not saying it's like trying to withhold information, like make you pay for it. But like, one of the things that I see,
I'll be on the coaching call, Graham.
Yeah. But no, one of the things, I'll just tell you up front, one of the things that I think you're doing wrong from a growth perspective is doing live streams. I think they're terrible for the algorithm.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So you doing these live streams is hurting the reach of your future.
Oh, my God.
Hey! Hey! Oh, God. You guys log off right now. You're hurting the channel.
Really?
Hey, wow.
I thought everything adds on YouTube. I thought YouTube is just like, the more you give, the more we give. But
because long live streams like this lower the overall click-through rate. So very few people are likely to go back and watch your live stream. So YouTube sees that as a not very performing video,
Oh, God.
And so you're less likely to recommend future content after that.
So
what would have been better for you to do
right.
is if you want to do live streams, make a second channel for that. Call it.
We have it. We're trying to get people to go subscribe. No one goes and subscribes, guys.
Hey, subscribe to the drip, everyone.
Can you tell the people to go subscribe to the drip, please?
Go subscribe and hit the like button if you haven't done that already.
You're the king of that. You go hit the like button and you got that big smile and yeah. I can't help but click the stupid like button. I'm like, how does this guy do it? How do you
like,
do it? That's amazing. I can never, like, I literally have a cameo from Anna Anka where she tells me, like and subscribe. And that's the best way I know how to do it because I can't deliver it like you do. Like, hey, guys, you even have ways to say it. Like, you're like, go poke the like button. Hey, go cuddle with the like button.
I mean, you're always the game. You like flip it up. Game.
What's going on with that?
Gamify it. You sell them on.
Interesting.
It's just fun. And at this point, it started off originally as me. I don't want to say mocking, but there were some channels like 3 years ago that would go crazy.
Right.
Make sure to smash that like button, guys. And so I started doing it as a joke. And then people really took onto it. And I was like, wait a second. Maybe this is the thing. So then I started just having fun with it. And now it's just become this thing. It's like, smash the like button.
Cool. That's cool. That's cool.
That's a lesson.
I'm even getting, by the way, a neon sign. That when you walk in the front door, it's gonna say smash the like button.
That's good. Guys, smash the like button, please. Listen.
Smash the like button, guys. We don't ask you enough, do we? That's
listen,
great.
Guys, like everyone in the chat, you're hurting my channel right now. I want you guys to know that. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot to all of you.
We're gonna move over to that
channel
soon.
Here's the thing. Yeah, we're planning to move over there once we have enough like followers who like the podcast. We're gonna move over exclusively there. I always heard that YouTube treats live and uploads on different like planes. Like basically live performance versus upload performance is actually different. That's what I'd always heard. Just like one of the YouTube guys was saying that, let's say you have a video go live on Reddit, right? Like go viral on Reddit. And people aren't watching for very long from Reddit. YouTube does not penalize you on their recommendations for like watch later or like related videos. For how your video is performing on Reddit, they treat them as independent metrics.
I've never heard of that. My understanding is that every view is counted equally. So let's say if you link a video, like here's a good example that I've experimented
Where's
with.
Roberto Blake? Hey, put stuff in chat, Roberto Blake. He's in chat. Blake. Come on. Come on, people.
He's great. But one of the things that I've been testing out is on Instagram. So when you do like a swipe up to watch a video, well, when you swipe up, you're still on Instagram watching a YouTube video.
Okay.
And if you have like a 15-minute video, swipe up on Instagram, people are not going to sit on Instagram and watch the entire thing.
Correct.
So realistically, what you're going to have is a whole bunch of people swiping up for the first like 30 seconds. Maybe they're logged in, maybe they're not, and they're going to be clicking out. So that can actually hurt YouTube's rankings of your videos because they see people clicking in and then clicking out of it.
Wow.
Interesting. I need to hear from Roberto Blake because I think he literally, I saw the recommendation like guy from Google, like from the guy who makes the recommendation engine, or he's like one of the leads. He talked about it. He's like, they're separate, but I could be wrong. I thought I saw that actually on one of Roberto Blake's posts.
Here's what I think, and I don't want to say anything bad about YouTube, but sometimes I feel like they'll say one thing, but then when you test it out, something else will be different.
They always look out to lunch, honestly, don't they?
Here's the thing. They said this about monetization. They say non-monetized videos
perform
are not going to have any of the algorithm. My own experience and the experience I've seen from pretty much every other creator universally is that monetized videos do better. If you put a mid-roll ad in a video, they do better almost every single time. So YouTube says it doesn't matter. My experience has been it does.
Right. Wow, guys. I tried That's to defend great. You at home. I tried to give you the recommendation guy at YouTube, but he's lying to us. I actually kind of agree. I've seen them say stuff that's totally not true. I definitely have.
When I hear people from YouTube, it always sounds like they're saying, "What I know, God is algorithm. No algorithm." They're like the algorithm is mysterious, brother.
But
this will happen. Do this. This will happen. Who knows?
Think of it from their perspective. They would never come out and say, "Guys, we're pushing the videos that are strongly monetized. Only monetized content is going to prevail."
Sure.
They would never come out and say it.
But
so some things I feel like
algorithm.
It's a secret code or something like that, but that's just been my experience.
I think that it's that videos that are demonetized tend to also be rated a different rating on like YouTube. Like they're not PG, they're rated M. And so because of that, you're getting less performance. I know they de-rank stuff that's rated M.
About 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, I did a test where I didn't monetize one of my videos. It horribly. And I thought, okay, maybe that's a fluke. So about a week and a half later, did another one. Didn't monetize for the first 24 hours. Same thing. And as soon as I turned on monetization, started to pick back up a little bit.
Yeah, turn on that favor.
Those scumbags, dude. They've been lying to us all along. Oh my gosh.
They're trying to get money, you know? They probably don't even tell the employees, maybe. Who knows? They gotta get their money.
It makes sense that they only have so many videos to recommend. There's only 30 slots, let's just say. So would they be promoting content that's not advertiser friendly? It doesn't make them anything. They're hosting a platform.
Well, not advertiser friendly, because you said regardless of whether it's advertiser friendly. You're saying if they're not making money for it, why would they promote it? I see it. They just say otherwise, but I mean, I do see what you're saying. Like, it's probably, it could be not true.
That's why a lot of people are saying that everyone got canceled like a couple of years ago. When all the big networks came into YouTube, a lot of people have this conspiracy. Maybe it sounds true from what you're saying, that like, someone called it adpocalypse, but they were saying that like, if you say anything offensive, they just cancel you, because they're like, we don't want Dove to say no. You know what I mean? Like Gavin McInnes is doing whatever videos, and then they're like, so they just started kicking people out like that.
That's when it gets difficult, because I understand it from their perspective that they're trying to make a platform that can be self-sufficient, and they can't have people going and saying whatever they want and turning the platform into this mess. Mm-hmm. So they have to be somewhat careful about the content they push.
We're going through a cleanup.
Right.
The pickup artist, done.
I mean, but within a certain extent, it does make sense. I mean, it is their platform. They are hosting the content. I have no idea what goes on in the back.
You're being way too nice to Google. I feel like, hey, you guys are the only platform for video. Let's be real, right? Where else are you going to put your video? On Facebook? No. So because of that, they're a public utility. That's my thought. I mean, I understand what you're saying. Legally, technically, yes. I think it's wrong what they're doing, but I think technically, yes. But I always come out and say, no, they're not. What they're doing is not right about censoring all this kind of content. I think they like create a weird world where you can only have certain types of voices out there because of the fact that everyone's just incentivized by the views. They don't give any views to anybody who doesn't do exactly what they want. And so they come out with this, you know, it's like, it's people are evolutionary, like people will just evolutionarily respond to rewards. And so if you put the trees high, everyone becomes giraffes, and we don't want that. Like, ideally you want a level playing field where there isn't a bunch of unfair bias. And I get what you're saying about like, it's their platform, but I also think it's starting to become a worldwide platform that's just like, it's, I don't know. At what point does it become like, you know, water or food? Like, the internet's the public square now.
Yeah. I mean, like I said, I mean, the way I see it, it's their platform. That's not to say that at some point in the future, maybe something else comes up. So who knows?
Yeah, fair enough.
Free market decides, Steven. Okay, there's some leftist views you're bringing on there. Very leftist. What do you want, government control?
I'm in the middle, baby. I'm in the middle. I'm like Graham with politics. Well, I stay political with politics because I don't talk about politics. That's how you become political with politics. £5, Nick Visser. You should put the other channels in your featured channels. $20 from Roberto Blake. It was Todd from YouTube. I can ask some stuff for you, but I agree with Graham in this. It may be unintentional. Also, yes, the rating, because Nerd City. I've seen without ads because sponsored videos do well. Oh.
Roberto, yeah, you're speaking in like rhymes there, but you got all that?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Okay, he basically says Graham's right, but he can ask.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to know. Yeah. I'd love to know. Because if that's true, hey, the drip might be dead, guys. Hey, this might be the last episode of the drip. I'm hurting myself.
That's it.
It depends what your goal is. I would say if your goal is to reach as many people as possible, it would be a good idea to not do these live streams here. Do them separately. Good.
We've been planning on it, but it may accelerate our plans a little
bit. Or how about this? Record these episodes and then upload it as a video separately on another channel. I just have never seen or had any good experiences with a live stream before.
Interesting.
Good call, man.
I usually take the videos off because I don't want like people getting burnt out on a video that's like real. I just go live, and then as soon as they're off on my channel, I unlist them and re-upload the full thing to the Drip, the actual channel. Is that even worse? Oh my God.
Oh God, that's even worse. Man, that's now we're playing with YouTube.
Listen, I knew I was better than my views suggest. Yeah. I knew that I was better than that.
Listen, if you try this out for 2 months, for 60 days, I will almost guarantee to you, you'll see at least 20%, 25% more views.
Wow.
This.
This is great. This is good. We're getting consulting, man. This is amazing.
This is a good consulting call right here.
No more live streams, and no more unlisting videos.
People love
do the
live streams
on another channel, or, well, I was about to say you could pre-film these and then just upload the whole thing.
What about community posts? Can I post to the community, or is like that not allowed? Like, no.
I haven't seen any connection between community posts and more engagement and less engagement.
Okay, because I was thinking of linking the live stream from the community post, so then people from Coffeezilla still get the notification.
Yes.
All right, I'm gonna try it, Graham. You know what? You're changing minds. You're changing hearts. Okay.
Just try it. Worst case is I'm wrong. You could tell me I'm wrong, and then you could go back to the same thing.
Everyone's saying live stream on Twitch, dude. Who? Are you guys all on Twitch? Like, is that where you guys all are? I see people go from YouTube to Twitch and they have like 2 viewers. Nobody's on Twitch.
Yeah, that's what we're worried about going to a new channel. Because Graham, even from his last channel, he's at 350K. Then this channel is hitting 200K now. It's like, guys, do the sub.
Guys, he's not killing the Drip. You just have to go subscribe to the Drip over on YouTube. Yeah. I feel like Joe Rogan. I feel like Joe Rogan right now is trying to get everyone to move to Spotify, and no one wants to move to Spotify.
Nobody wants to
He's like, please, the podcast isn't ending. And if you look at his like YouTube comments, usually it's like, rip, guys, I'll miss you, whatever. It's like, Joe Rogan's not dying. He's moving. People hate moving. They don't like it.
A lot of people think he sold out, though. A lot of people think he's like, they're just being hard on him, I think, too, some people. They're like, why'd you give in? Why'd you go to Spotify?
Or, I do miss seeing those videos on YouTube, though.
I know, honestly, me too.
I don't spend a lot of time on Spotify. So for me to go and see Joe Rogan, I have to like actually go on Spotify and seek him out. Versus on YouTube, I like that it's just recommended to me. If YouTube knows that like, hey, I'm going to be interested in hearing this video, it's going to put it in my feed. So a lot of what I find too is just organically through whatever YouTube recommends.
Could
that hurt him, Graham? Or no? He's too big.
I mean, I think at this point it's just a business decision for him, and I think $100 million, and I heard rumors that it's way more than that. I think for him it's just about having that creative expression. He's able to make a lot of money doing that. My own personal preference would have been for him to stay on YouTube, but that's just because me selfishly, I like getting recommended these videos because I spend so much time on YouTube.
They're great videos.
I like it. That's the reason I like it. It just shows up for me. $5 from Morgan, and then we have a giant super chat. What do you do? How do you analyze your video data to improve your content? Be as advanced as possible, trying to grow my channel and make more engaging content. Then we have $100 from Financial Education. Wow.
Oh!
Wow. Thank you.
Graham talked me into doing mid-rolls. This is from Financial Education. Graham talked me into doing mid-rolls a couple years ago, and it was a game changer. Yes, live streams hurt big time. When I've done live streams in the past, it hurts the next video or two. Big time. Dude, what? Hey!
Wow. I had
hey,
no idea.
Listen, guys, here I've been doing like things by right myself now. When I should have been taking Graham's course. Actually, that's not true. Graham, actually, I took your course. I've been hiding this from you. Yeah. Well,
did you actually buy it? You did. What do you think?
I'm not going to answer that. Listen. Okay.
Oh, wait. Don't tell me you did one of these things where it was like,
You jacked his
class?
Like,
you told
him?
PayPal me and I'll
Graham, I would never do that. Of course, of course not, Graham. I would never do that to you. Listen, no, before when I knew we were doing this, I was like, well, I want to go look at his course. I try to do this for a lot of gurus that I watch. I've watched a million courses, guys. Cool. But I never feel like I should show their course content because I'm like, I don't know if that's crossing a line. Even though some of it I should like rip into, but it's a paywall. So I don't want to abuse the paywall idea.
Yeah. How about this? You don't have to... if you want to show my course, you can. I mean, I trust you wouldn't show. It's like 9 hours.
Bits
and pieces. That's fine with me.
No, but I watched your course, and I thought.
Did you watch all 8 hours?
I watched a lot of it. There was some of it that there was a lot of it that I just knew. There's a lot of it that I was just like, yeah, I know, you know, this kind of stuff, how to get started, all that stuff.
I would have bought it. It's out of my price range. And I didn't want to rip your course, dude, so I didn't get it. But I'll get it.
I thought it was really interesting, and all I could think of is, like, I was like, wow, this would be great if it was a bit more accessible. Like, $500 is just a lot of money. And
it's
that's
not,
where
it's not $500.
Or it's what, $300?
I know, it said it was 200.
Was it 397? But I do plenty. I think I do like 3 or 4 sales throughout the year where it's 197.
Gotta do the sales.
Yeah, I didn't get the sale. I got the $300 thing. And I was like, this is like, I would buy a book for this. I was like, I would love to see this in a book. Cause I feel like books set information at a comfortable place for me. Books are like $20. And then they tell you a lot, and they tell you people's experience, and you get like years of information. And maybe that skewed my opinion, but I really do feel like that's the way people should value information, because especially for courses for beginners, if I was starting out, I could not have afforded your course because I was on a runway. Because I basically finished engineering. I was living off an engineering salary. And basically, I had only so much money before I had to just, I was like paying barely at the edge of rent, you know, all this stuff. And I was trying to make YouTube a thing before I had to basically go get a regular job. So if at that point, buying a course would have shortened that runway for me, and it was really important that I got that time to practice in. And so the information would have been valuable, but it would have shortened my, what do you call it, runway. And I feel like that's true for all beginner courses. What is most important to a beginner is that they just have time to throw spaghetti against the wall, right? And just like see what works for them. And when you charge for beginner information, you're cutting off that ability to have that runway. This is why, especially like with e-commerce stuff, it's like they charge $3,000. Hey, that guy could have used $3,000 for, you know, for their inventory. That's like, that's, you're chopping the guy at the knees while telling you're gonna help them. So I like the course, but I felt like it should have been cheaper.
Okay. Okay, so two things. First of all, I wouldn't necessarily call it beginner information, because I would say first half of it is pretty introductory. The second half, the deep dives into the analytics and the types of titles, thumbnails, and SEO, I would say is a little bit more advanced. Yeah. Second thing, reading a book on how to make videos makes no sense to me. It makes sense that you would watch a video on how to make videos.
No, yeah, yes, yes. No, I'm saying the price of information, though. The price of information, books have set the standard for me of like, they're a perfect amount to where they're valuable. The person can make money by selling it. But at the same time, they're at a price point where it does not affect, especially if you're a beginner looking to start something, it does not affect your ability to pay rent. It does not affect any, it won't change your way of living.
I wouldn't buy a book. I know very few people under 25 who buy books and read books.
Do you read books?
Do I?
Yeah.
I haven't read a book in a long time. I do audiobooks.
I do audio. I'm all audio.
Audiobooks, or I want to say this, for the last like 3 years, 99% of what I do is just listening to YouTube videos. I'll put on like Jeremy, Financial Education. He puts out these 20, 30 minute long videos. I just listen to them as I'm cleaning the house or as
I'm cooking. Kevin is a quite educational, I find.
Yes. I literally watch every single one of Kevin's videos. He's like 5 videos a day.
You must be watching all of the time then, because Kevin puts out a ton of content. Yeah. I actually don't know. He blows me away. I like look at him and he's like, when I'm writing my goals for the next year, I'm like, meet Kevin, like level of he, I don't know how he pumps out so much content. But no, I just always feel like books actually have a lot deeper information than YouTube videos. I watch a YouTube video and I barely understand the topic. Even if it's like a deep dive, supposed deep dive, I'm like, all right, yeah, I don't get like, but you read a book and you can talk, you can listen to experts. You can really explore ideas. I feel like you disagree, huh?
I disagree.
This is shocking. This is shocking to me. I've never heard this.
I'm a visual learner. So I don't learn by reading something in a book. I've enjoyed some books in the past. It's been like Think and Grow Rich, How to Win Friends and Influence.
Oh, yeah.
I've maybe
stuff.
5 or 10 books that I've read that I love. Okay. But I would say for everything else, I learn by watching someone do something. Hmm. Even if, like, if I had the choice between reading what they had to say versus just watching them say it, I would get so much more from just watching them say it.
But, yeah, but I mean, this could be personal preference too, but what if Penguin Random House came to you and said, hey, $2 million, we're transcribing the course, make a book, what's up? You'd take, yeah, right?
No, I feel like like people's thoughts on book or on videos are far less collected. Most people, first of all, don't script out their videos. And so they're just kind of like ranting. If they do script it out, it's meant to be short because people have short attention spans in videos. That's just like the nature of the medium. People typically, like the most they're going to do is they're going to watch for 30 minutes. Like very few people are watching hour long, 2 hour long, 3 hour long educational videos. You'll watch a podcast, right, for 3 hours. But it's like people just chatting. You're just watching people chat. But books, the reason Audible books are on average like 8 hours is because they just spend more time going into depth. And so I've always felt like the place to find depth, the place to find real education is actually in the books, not the video. But I mean, it could just be a personal preference thing.
I think it's a personal preference. And I think also it's just a different demographic. If you want to reach an 18-year-old kid and teach them how to save money, you're not going to do that from selling them a book. You're going to do that by Millionaire Reacts, how this person spends $300,000 a year in New York City. Wow. They're never going to go and seek out a book, how to save money.
Yeah, but I feel like the people who watch those videos are not actually going to learn the information because they're looking just for entertainment.
No, go on my subreddit, Reddit Graham Stephan. One of the top posts there is someone who started learning about personal finance by those Millionaire React videos. What started off just to be like a fun little thing, hey, let me poke some fun at people for spending too much money, gets people into finance. It gets them excited, like, wow, this is actually kind of cool now to save money. Wait a second, I'm overspending. What would Graham think about this? Okay, now how could I look at this further?
Huh. 100%.
Interesting. Read that entire post on the Graham Stephan subreddit.
I will, if you read a book. I want you to read a book. And it's kind of unfair. I'm going to read a subreddit and I want you to read a book. But I do suggest read Amusing Ourselves to Death by Neil Postman. I think you'll find that interesting. It changed my mind. Huh?
I'll watch a YouTube essay
There's definitely an audiobook available. But it basically breaks down how books and video are different mediums for more than just like one's audio or one's, reading versus one's like a visual thing. But I think you'll find it interesting. So I'll read your subreddit post, though. I do find that interesting. And, interesting. $50 from Shane Hummus. God. Oh, this guy's a big Graham Stephan fan. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
I paid for Graham's course when I was 80 subscribers on YouTube, well worth the cost, right at the point, and he emphasized things that actually make a difference, which probably saved me hundreds of hours of testing. Cheers, Shane.
Shane Hummus.
Okay, Shane, GPS. That's a very nice, wow. Hey,
that's great.
He
didn't even shout out his own
sort of stuff that I never expected to see, that sort of stuff.
You didn't pay this guy. This guy's coming in on his own. No, I'm just kidding. I'm joking. No, of course, man.
AF, $5. I feel like the biggest thing you can gain from reading books is that it trains you to be patient. No, guys, the way you structure an argument in a book and structure thought in a book is just different than video. You can carry conceptual and abstract information much better in a book. Think about it this way. There's some things that fit better in a movie than in a book, right? Like, but there's also, the corollary is also true. So think about this. Do you ever see a character think in a movie? No, because it plays poorly. How do you show a character thinking? You can't. Everything has to be in dialogue. Abstract things play poorly on a screen. It just doesn't work. On a book, you can get into those ideas. You can get into someone's head. I feel like they carry different types of information. And I find that books are just much better for thinking deeply about a subject. This is just my opinion. I mean, I guess a lot of young people aren't reading anymore.
Can I say something after Graham? True. No, Graham, tell us what you think.
I think this is just you.
Yeah.
But I also think from my own perspective, it's easier to understand information when they're not talking in such a way that seems too scripted. When they're talking in a casual manner as though just someone else and I are having a normal conversation. I'm just sitting in a room with somebody and they're just freestyling for 20 minutes. Sometimes there's really good information in that. For my own videos, I'm very careful about what I say when I say it. I try to make it flow. Not everyone does that. I try to do it to save on time. But it's just, I think for you, that might make sense. But I think for a lot of people under 25 or 30, just freestyling videos.
How old are you? Also, are you older than me or I'm 26? Are you?
I'm 30.
Oh, okay.
I saw the video about 30. But yo, Steven, one thing that I think might make you sad, actually, is that because I usually write for TV. That's like what I do for work when I can get work. But what I'm finding as I'm taking sales courses, because I'm taking a lot of sales courses right now for the show, Graham, and what I'm finding is that everything's kind of written the same. Like, even if you look at Donald Miller's Story Brand, he's talking about taking someone on a hero's journey. And then movies are supposed to be on a hero's journey. A TV show is like a miniature one, and then the scene is also supposed to be like that. But then you look at how people are telling you to write YouTube videos. Very similar thing. I mean, the process of taking someone, and even a client meeting, let's say, Graham, I don't know if you're into client meeting or any, if you've done these sales training things, but like, even like the way Chris Doe, let's say, talks about like doing a meeting with a potential client, right? You're not selling them. You're taking them through a process where you come to an agreement on like, this is a cool project that we should do. It's going to make you money. It's exactly what you want. And I'm going to get paid this much. Like, that's ideally how you're supposed to go. And even that process of changing someone's mind from someone who's a client calling you, cold calling, whatever, and getting them to buy from you or whatever, even that is such a hero's journey. So I feel like everything's kind of written the same when it's tight. That's what I'm learning anyway, just from all the screenwriting classes I've taken and now all the marketing classes I'm taking. I'm like, this is the same thing. It's teach the same thing, no matter what.
Yeah, you got to structure your information well. I mean, definitely. $5 from Brian. You articulated the book first movie thing so well. I have to donate. Love the show. Guys, we have 5 minutes left with Graham. Give me all your questions for Graham, please. Yeah. Hit me with
Graham,
the comments.
We have abundance.
We're going to have a rapid fire round. Ravens fan, $5. What do you think of the practice or medicine and law private practice as a business and how they develop? Not sure if this makes sense. I don't know anything about
that.
Yeah, sorry. We're going to have to skip that one. Cool. We got to stay within our wheelhouse here. Graham, can I get you to commit right now live on air while I got you here to come back next time? Come back again.
Yeah. I want you on the podcast.
Yeah. So how about I'm going to fly down. I'll fly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But I have to fly out for yours. It's different, but I'm down.
So much fun now.
Yeah.
You're going to have a blast.
No, I actually feel like, yeah, we're going to have a great time. Alaric 70 Czar. Okay. What are people saying? Trader Nick, thank you for the YouTube tips. Big fan of both channels. Definitely yin yang channels. We definitely are, Graham. Whether you want to believe it or not.
To a certain extent, but I would say we do share a lot in common as well.
Yeah, no, that's what I mean. We
come watch a lot of your videos. I would say probably 85-90% of your videos I watch them.
We come from different perspectives on similar topics, but I feel like at the end of the day, we do agree on a lot. That's what I meant by yin and yang. Okay, come on, guys. Some real questions here. If you see any questions you want to answer, by the way, Graham, just feel free to jump in here.
I'm not looking at the chat at all.
Graham, okay. I feel like these guys that are calling out these fake gurus, they have like an abundance limit. We're rocking out around like 400,000, 500. We're talking in the 100,000. You're in the millions. How do we get this abundance, brother? I guess you're saying one thing, live stream. Watch the live streams.
Yeah.
One thing from Graham's thing, his course. I'll tell him what your course says. Your course says don't focus too much on other people's content. Focus on your own content, right? Because you want to be known for your own content. That's one of your tips, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. What would you say, though, to his question?
Oh, what would I say?
Yeah.
I would say it's so analytical. You really got to look at titles and thumbnails, see what people are watching, see when they're clicking out of your videos, see what you can improve on for the next one, and consistency. Because even if you do everything right, if you're not uploading consistently on a regular basis, it all goes out the window. Just like you could be uploading consistently, but if you don't optimize titles and thumbnails and look at what's being recommended, like my biggest piece of advice is always go to the homepage and see what YouTube is recommending to you. Those are the videos that YouTube is wanting to push. Look at their titles and look at their thumbnails. See what they're doing and see how you can incorporate some of that into your own video.
Be a student of the competition.
Right.
I think that's smart. $5. I read books and listen to Audible on YouTube Premium. I suggest listening on playback 1.5 speed. Yep, I do that. Yep. What does Graham think about drop shipping? A good question.
I don't really know too much about it, to be honest. Okay. The closest thing I've ever done to that was print on demand merch, I don't want to call it a failure, but I've trained my audience so hard not to spend money that it's like I can't sell merch. Graham, you told me not to spend money.
I've fantasized about putting together a course and you get all the way to the credit card information page before a page comes up and it's like, I taught you better than this. And it's like, and then like push the courses if you're selling a course.
After that.
Yeah. Alaric, 75 Czar. Everyone has ADHD since the invention of the micropressor, so we can't read books anymore. Sorry. Okay, fair enough.
Okay.
Roberto Blake, $5. Who's Graham's favorite entertainment channel? Not Pewds or Beast, though.
Ooh.
Oh, good question.
Oh, I would say, so I have two. Danny Duncan.
I love Danny. Okay.
Yeah.
This gets funny.
Probably Nelk would be my two off-topic channels.
Yeah.
That's my guilty pleasure.
You have very good taste, by the way.
Good taste. We were just talking about Nelk. So tight.
Oh, and also Cody Coe.
Cody Coe's funny. Yeah, he's hilarious. Yeah. Ravens fan, $5. What does Graham think about the dating guru industry? Wow, we're getting all of it.
Mm.
Dating guru industry. You were a fan of Simple Pickup. It's in your course.
Yep. Yeah.
See, I watched it.
Wait, I never bought their course or anything.
But you were a fan of their videos, though, right?
Yeah, I love their videos. I thought they were awesome. I don't know too much about like the dating industry like that. I do think there's two things. One, I think there's some really good information out there, and I also think there's some really toxic information out there. I think when you go too far in the one direction of just like hating women, that's where it's weird. It's strange, and I think it's awful.
Nice.
But I do think there is some good information out there just to improve your general confidence. And I think really at its core, it's just about being comfortable in who you are as a person. And when you have a belief about yourself that you are worthy, that generally translates into your conversations as well.
Awesome. Graham, it's 5 o'clock. Yeah. Let me read two more super chats and then we'll go. Okay, guys, stop super chatting for Graham because he's not going to be able to get him. We got to get him out of here. He's on a tight schedule, guys. Respect his time, please. Okay, you're killing the channel and you're not respecting Graham. Come on,
6 p.m.
$5. Kathy, Joe, Gallo, love that both channels. Thanks. Oh, thanks, Kathy. Joe, Jorge Ronis. Graham, are you interested in getting into large multifamily complexes?
At this point, probably not. I just really want to simplify things at this point. I've kind of realized like the less stress I have, the better. The less obligation I have, the better. I've got at this point, I think it's like 9 tenants at this point, or like it's like 10 tenants, something like this. And it's too difficult to start to keep track of. I've just been index funding it lately. And I love the simplicity of just like two buttons, done.
Yeah.
No phone calls, no nothing. Sure, I get a little bit less of a return, but it's just, it makes up for it and just the stress. So,
good call.
$5 from Just Jay. Thanks, man. And I guess that's it, huh? Yeah, you got it wrong.
We don't want to do that one?
Is there anything else?
Oh, no, sorry. There is one more. I thought you did this. I thought, okay. Graham, what do you think of Kevin David and Mike Vestal? Please ask this, please. $5 from Just Jay.
$5 from Just Jay.
Sorry, I did not ask.
Wait, time to leave.
That's Just Jay.
Thank you,
just
guys.
I know, it's like time.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
All right, man.
Hey, next time. We'll
hey, thanks
answer.
For coming on the show. We'll have you back. I'll go on your podcast. Sounds good, man. Appreciate you.
Sounds good. Thanks, guys. See ya.
Take care.
Thanks, guys.
See ya.
See ya.
Bye. Dude, what a gentleman. Right.
What a great guy, dude.
What a sweet
guy. He is living in abundance. I'll tell you that right now. He's living in abundance.
I honestly do like, I do think you can learn a lot from people like that who are very, you know, they say be nice to the people on your way up because then you'll see them on your way down or whatever. He's very much like, I think Graham will not have any enemies. Right.
No.
Whereas
never.
I think I'm going
to caution.
It's very sales.
Audio? No audio. Oh, hello. Yes, we're back, guys. Sorry.
Yeah, you can tell he has done sales training.
We're good. Everyone's saying no audio. We know. I hate how I get stuff late, and they're like telling me like they tell me
know,
like 15 like, seconds late, and I'm like, oh shoot. Yeah, we're good.
They're
we're good.
Telling you.
We're good. They say it's back.
I haven't had much of my drink, but 200K, baby. That's great. Living in the abundance and calling people out. Like, that's why what you do is so much harder, right? He's all positive. There's no downside. Think about what you do, man. You have people coming back after you. There is a price for what you do on the channel. Like, these guys come after you. They're like, Graham has no enemies. There's nothing. He just goes, when you say, hey, this guy's a sociopath, he goes, well, you know, we don't need to talk about that. Why don't we talk about something positive?
But I mean, I think it's good. Like I said, I think we are a lot of yin and yang because at the end of the day, a lot of the advice he's giving is just common sense, personal finance, and stuff I agree with. If you actually listen to what he says, he's like, hey, go ahead, don't spend money, you know, be frugal. And if you actually take that to heart, you're not going to go buy overpriced stuff. It's like, it's fine. So I just feel like we come at it from different angles. What are we going to call this? We got to rename the drip real quick. What are we calling this episode?
What do we call it now?
We're going to call it post game.
We're talking about post game. Post game with Graham Stephan, man, with a YouTube legend, baby. He was he's great. What a gentleman! Such a sweet guy. Like, he comes on. Like, yeah, he's very charming, and
there
he's learned.
Here we go.
He's trained in that. You know what I'm saying? Like, it is the sales mentality, dude. I'm telling you, I'm in Vince Del Monte's 7-figure mastermind right now. I'm just like checking some of it out.
Yeah. Oh, Amish, we're having so many issues right now, ladies and gentlemen. Amish has terrible internet. Yeah, OBS is crashing right now.
It's church, dude. They come in freezing.
Yeah, you're fine. You're fine. No, you're good.
Okay, cool. Yeah, no, he's got a very positive mindset, man. It's positive.
People are saying, somebody said, Azrael, why didn't you ask him about Dan Locke? I did.
We did.
Guys, I asked him the questions, people. You got to watch the whole show. Get better internet, Steven. It's not my internet. Ladies and gentlemen, hey, I'm going to have to point the finger. Amish, at Frozen Amish. I'm pointing the finger at Frozen Amish. This is Amish's internet. Canada doesn't have good internet, people. What people are saying, rip, stream gone? What? Is the stream gone? Literally, what is going on?
Yeah, Marky Gunn is like, my internet. Listen, this is Rogers. This is Rogers business. Yeah, now it's saying my internet connection is unstable.
Oh my gosh. I think he's got Rogers, guys. Connection. They're saying Graham pulled the plug. No, he doesn't do that. People love Graham Stephan, dude.
Oh my!
I actually do learn from Graham. I gotta be honest. Of all the people that I watch on YouTube in the personal finance like place, he's the one guy that I actually listen to because I think he does have some really good advice. He is very thoughtful about his branding.
He's tight, man.
Yeah,
he's tight.
Guys,
he's undeniable.
You gotta go subscribe to the Drip. The Drip might not be here next week. Graham says it's killing the channel. Amish, please call for the internet abundance.
The internet, man.
Hey, people are saying call.
What is this internet? There's no abundance for me. Where's my internet? I just want internet abundance, man. I just want waves of internet. Gigabyte.
You're freezing as you're asking for waves of internet. What does this tell you guys about the abundance mindset here? I don't know. You have a negative mindset over there, Amish. That's what I'm sensing. Canada slander. Coffeezilla, interview the creator of YouTube, the YouTube competitor. There is no YouTube competitor, unfortunately. I wish there was. Not a real internet competitor. Roberto Blake, I followed Graham's advice for my retirement portfolio and a little bit of Ryan's.
It's coming my way. Where's my gigabyte?
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, look. Holding on for dear life. It's saying, hold on, internet. Hold on to the sea. Hold on to the signal. Hold on to the internet. Come on. We are breathing abundance into this internet.
You're coming.
We are breathing abundance.
Yeah.
There is abundance. Come. God's favor is on this internet. Come on, y'all. Man, there is honestly no better option. I'm so sorry, guys.
No, it's okay. He's literally buying the best money can buy in Canada, and that's okay. You get Justin Trudeau internet. You don't have that Trump internet. Sorry.
I got to come to America. You know, that's what God's saying. God's saying, go to America, Amish. Go to America.
The land of the free, home of the brave, home of the Wi-Fi.
Capitalists will get you internet. Yeah.
What are people saying? Somebody's saying, Coffeezilla, can you bring Trin Black on the show? Yeah, dude, he's invited. I've been needing to get him on. It's just schedules haven't worked out. David Distracavivo, Graham gives good life advice, but not the best career advice or personal development. You should check out Denise Sasal. All right, don't promote people, guys. Come on.
Like, you know, there's like a 50% chance with our crowd that's going to be a con artist, right?
Yeah,
you know that.
50%. If not 90%. That's probably some Bitcoin scammer. Sorry if it's not, but we're guessing.
He's the Dan Locke of Serbia. Hey.
Amish.
Don't need it. I don't need your fight on, guys. He's the Dan Locke of Serbia. Don't need it. Sounds worse. Sounds terrifying. Don't tell him about me.
Oh, gosh. We got to fix this internet, Amish. We got to
do
something. We're literally going to run a giant LAN cable from my house all the way to Canada. I live in Texas, by the way, guys. All the way to Canada. That's what we're going to do.
I'm coming to you, man. I'm coming to you. I'm going to come. I got to come to America. That's it.
Yeah.
I got to fill out my forms. This is God saying, Amish, fill out your tax forms. Fill them out.
You got to do it. Amish hates filling out forms. I've been trying to get him to fill out the same form for, what, 2 months now? Almost 2 months.
I had it in my schedule, like today, do the form, and then I'm like, Graham Stephan.
Are you on Wi-Fi? Are you Ethernet?
I'm on a double. I have a double thing. I have Ethernet. I have the Ethernet, but then I also have this Wi-Fi cable. No, I have Wi-Fi, but then I also have a cable that runs through the power line. It's called the power line internet, which doesn't even work.
No, this doesn't make sense. Do you have a cable running from the router to your computer?
I do, but it's a power line cable.
What does that
mean?
That's
the thing. It means that it's this thing called the power line. It's plugged in. I'll show you next time, but it plugs into the wall and then a Wi-Fi cable comes out of it. It doesn't work that well though. Now, the thing is that I had the technician here and he goes, yeah, it just cuts out. He goes, first of all, you're not going to get over 500, even if you connect in.
You don't need 500. You just need 50, but constant 50.
Yeah, constant 50. Yeah, that's it. But they just are like, we just have cutouts. There's like no resolution for cutouts. In the business line, they go, okay, if it was out for an hour, we'll give you this much money. They have that. People are like, that's the best anyone's going to give you.
Hey, Amish, people are saying I should go on Rogan. What do you think? I don't know if I'm not at that level yet. You got to be at another level.
No, you need to be on Rogan right now. Yes,
no,
of course.
No.
You
I don't have. Look, so many people go on Rogan. This guy's right. Okay, he goes, I think Zilla on Rogan would work for exactly the reason I don't think I'd work on Rogan. But he'd have to pick his top three stories and run hard with them. That's the problem. If you're going to be on Rogan, you need some life experience and you need more than three stories. You like anybody who goes on Rogan, they need to have like 7 or 8 killer stories. And then you're broadcasted to like 18 million people and you blow up. But the problem is I see a lot of guys go on Rogan and they don't have the stories and it's not fun.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't want to be that guy going on and being like, have two stories. And then it's just, you can always tell because it's like a 2 hour podcast, right? You can tell when it's like 2 hours, you're like, oh, it sucks.
No. We do a writing meeting. We got to have a writing meeting before that. We go your topics just like we do this. I mean, unless it's like Graham Stephan, we just rip and dip quick, but like you got to go into Joe Rogan with your stories. Honestly, this week, dude, I was talking to some other comics, even about the basic scam stuff. And they loved it, dude. They're just like, oh my God, they do what? Like, nobody knows about this. We're bored of it a little bit because we do it every week. But outside, people are like, oh my God, what is this world?
That's true. They are kind of like blown away when they first find it. I agree.
I was telling someone about they run to the back to get the course move. I was telling some like civilians about it. They went crazy. They're like, oh my God, you got to show this to me. They love that shit. Dude, we've seen it so many times, so we're not even surprised anymore.
People are saying go with Amish. I agree. You'd have to go. I mean, I feel, well, maybe. I don't know how the vibe would be, but I feel like it'd be better maybe if you went with
me. Yeah. I mean, we honestly, I was just thinking this week, we just got to meet. We got to have a writing meeting and then we do our show. You know what I'm saying? Like, we got to meet more often, me and you. We got to just talk about the channel. What are we going to do? What are our topics?
Hey, when you come live in Texas, we can talk about it.
I know, dude.
Come move to Rogan country.
Exactly. He's there too. That's the thing. But I think PBD might be the move to Rogan. Like, it's all just about hits and it's about people messaging Rogan being like, hey, this guy's helping people. So you look at someone like Graham Stephan, sure, he grows faster, but it's all positive, positive, positive. I respect that. I get it. But you guys are all going to have a hard time cracking that million without some Joe Rogan, you know, hey, recognize our community, Joe Rogan.
No, dude, that's not true. You just have to level up your game. I look at Graham Stephan's success and I don't see like, oh, he did this, so therefore he's successful. He's just successful because he's a smart, charismatic guy who did smart content. And I'm going to continue to do good content, and I will grow too. I don't think that's a scarcity mindset, Amish. Shame on you.
No. But Graham is also on top of his collabs. He's always looking for the collab.
So are like we.
Graham's never going to say Joe Rogan. We don't need Joe Rogan. He's going to be like, yeah, we'll do that too.
Yeah.
And we'll do Patrick Bet David too.
He'll be
that's a bit of the issue with these guys, no?
John Pearson, yeah, I mean, I agree. John Pearson, congrats on 200K. I love Graham, but you're totally right about the written word. It's not just a different way to consume the same content. Yes, I didn't want to push that point because we didn't have time because we're running out of time, but I feel really strongly about it. I don't want it to seem like I do think it's just here nor there. I think Graham's wrong, and that's fine, but I think he's totally wrong about it.
And I came in the podcast on Graham's side on that. And I'll say this, we might be saying the same thing. What happens with the written word? It's not necessarily about the words. It's about your focus. When you have a book, there's nothing else. You are 100% focused and you're taking in information. You watch a YouTube video, they're flashing stuff, they're switching. You miss half of it.
No.
You're not getting the points. But
no, I disagree.
It's all written the same.
Wait.
It's all written the same.
No, it's not. No.
It's all a movie.
How many times do I have to say no? Yeah. It's.
Okay, I mean, let
me tell you how I feel about it. I feel like YouTube is and like free video and just video in general. It's a platform where people don't have the attention span, So the writers go in with a different mentality. I go into a video thinking, what's the bare minimum I need to tell you to get you to understand what I'm talking about? With a book, the mentality is, I can unpack this topic. It's a deep dive. People don't read books to barely understand a news article, right? That's how videos are. You watch a video, you barely understand what the article was. You could have read the article and gotten the same amount of information. A book is like going deep into a topic. You read all the great researchers. You understand their points. You understand how their research intersects with other researchers in that field.
Yeah.
And then you go and you come to some big understanding. You're never going to watch a video and actually understand that.
I mean, there's 40 in an 8-minute video for sure. Because 8-minute videos are like those like 2-minute in-depth reports on the news where they're like, hey, next we got an in-depth report on what's going on over here. And it's like, okay, you're scratching the surface barely. Sure, if the video is 8 minutes, but dude, have you seen shows like Philosophy Tube? I mean, whether you agree with him or not, he's going deep, man. He's doing 2-hour videos sometimes. It's just, like,
video is a persuasive medium. So he's like, he's trying to persuade you of something. But I don't think he's giving some unbalanced take of the research. I mean, maybe you could say
45 minutes. He's going deep in it. I'm saying,
but yeah, that's the longest you'll ever sit through a video. The audiobooks are like 7 hours, 8 hours.
Yeah,
so you're an eighth of the length. The best example you can give me is an eighth of the length of a book. And he has to throw in all these skits to keep you engaged. And he's like forced to throw in all these like creative things because that's just what you have to do if you're going to get someone to sit for 45 minutes.
Yeah. No, he has to write it. I mean, he has to write it like tight. But I would say a lot of book writers will tell you like, man, my editor told me like, hey, your fourth chapter is not tight. I'm bored. So then I had to go back and rewrite the fourth chapter. And then when you look at how each chapter is written, it's like, oh, it's the same four. It's almost like
there are some books like this. I agree with this. Some books, it's like 4 points that they repeat for 10 chapters. I agree.
Oh, the self-help game. Books are nonsense.
Yeah,
dude.
That's not what I'm talking about. Listen, guys.
Yeah, but you're talking about a real novel.
Yeah, real novels. I don't know how to say it other than I find it. What kind of surprised me is that anyone would make this argument, because I feel like if you read a book and then you watch a show on the same thing, you will immediately be able to tell that there's a difference in informational content.
I guess cut out a bunch. You got to cut the video.
But that's my point.
Yeah.
So that's all I'm saying. Hold on, real quick. 10 pounds. I'm telling you, Denise says, okay, he's a real deal. Blah blah blah. Blah. Just Jay, cover the Nikola Trevor Milton fraud. I thought Tom Nash already did that.
Oh, yeah. Nash came out with some Nikola video this week. That's right. Nash is putting some heat on that guy, the Nikola guy. What a name, dude. You had to come out with Nikola?
It's so smart.
There's already a Tesla.
You know they got all the support from that. Like, people just, like, fell into the, oh, it's Nikola? Oh, it's genius, bro.
Nikola? And is he from Texas, or he's from the States somewhere, that guy? That guy's an American, and he just said, I'm going to make a truck company, electric, calling mine Nikola. Come on. Why are you stealing
it's
the guy's
so silly. It's so silly.
I know.
But wait, hold on. Let's stay on topic real quick, because I want to finish this idea about the books. Book writers are not smarter than video editors. They create incorrect, biased content. What? It's not true. Look, guys, look at how long people take to do stuff, too. Like, book writers, most writers take a year to create their content. Video people like me, I spend like a day. And Graham Stephan spends like a day. Even when I was doing Coffee Break and I was like deep diving, I was spending a month on research. That's it.
Yeah.
I don't know as much as a guy who spent a year talking about stuff. It's just, come on, guys. The book that was recommended was Amusing Ourselves to Death by Neil Postman. It's one of the big reasons that I kind of lost my faith in Coffee Break. I didn't believe in like what I was doing anymore. I don't believe in the power of educational video. I think it's a big L. I think people need to read. And this is why I actually strongly disagree with Graham. Like, I think that people are becoming dumber by watching videos for their education. And I think they're becoming surfacely informed on a lot, but they barely understand what they think they understand.
What about John Oliver half hour deep dive into
again,
something?
It's kind of the same thing. Like, you barely understand it. I mean, it's persuasive though. It's emotionally captivating, and it can get you to form a strong opinion. But I don't think that opinion. I don't think you know what the researchers say by the end of the show. But I just feel very strongly about this. I know a lot of people, they don't read and they don't feel that way.
I mean, definitely John Oliver, his thing is scripted in a way that like, yeah, but he is, you know what they all are? It's like, they're essayists. So like all these classes, right? When you go into the class, not all of them do this, but some of them even teach this. They're like, your YouTube video is basically an essay. Some people call it a video essay. I find those video essays can get deep too, where it's like, okay, but they basically follow the structure of an essay. Now the length of an essay can be 500 pages. It can become a novel, or it could be, you know, an essay. Like you make one point, you have one thesis, one point. So I would almost look at a YouTube video, like a deep dive YouTube video is like one essay within, like, let's just say there's a book and they have like 10 points that they're making. Each chapter has to be structured like an essay too. So it's like each chapter is like this is the point that I'm going to make here, whatever. Like let's just say like a Yuval Harari type of book.
Yeah.
Like he has to follow a certain thing of like, I got to teach you this. And there's a method of teaching you. And I would say the YouTubes are like doing one chapter at a time and a book is a full thing.
But people don't stick around for chapters. People don't stick around for like, you could not do, I don't know. I don't know, guys. Maybe we disagree on this, but yeah. Videos make people curious about something to commit to reading books later. Yeah, I think videos are great for like introducing you to a topic. I think it's brilliant. And like even introducing yourself to some researchers you haven't seen, it's very compelling. But it's not a way to learn. And so when I was making content for people to learn, I remember on coffee break having a conversation with a guy who's like very high level in the educational space. And he told me, and I can't tell you who it is because I don't want to hurt, like,
that's fine.
I'm not going after anybody. But he said, people want to feel smart who watch these videos. They don't want to be smart.
Wow.
And that profoundly impacted me because I was trying to make videos for people to be smart, not for them to feel smart. And so he told me, you do that and you're not going to grow. You've got to make videos for people to feel smart, not be smart. And
that's
a black pill. I mean, when you're trying to make educational content and someone tells me, hey, you just want them to feel good about themselves, like pat, pat, pat. And this guy's right. It's like, Victor, video is entertainment. Yeah, it's a medium of entertainment. You're only going to keep people...
It's valuetainment.
It's vapid. It's vapid. People don't actually go to learn. They're constantly clicking off. And I knew when I was making videos, the longer I focused on a topic and like actually got into the nuance of a topic and didn't take a stand one way or the other because it's a complicated medium, all of a sudden I'm going to lose viewers. And I knew I took a strong stand, if I was super opinionated, if I simplified the research, I'd get millions of views.
Fox News, baby. They mastered that. They're good at that, man. Everyone else does.
Everybody who's popular in media knows this. Everybody who's like mastered media. One of my big videos was about the problem with the School of Life, where I accused them of simplifying their research. Until later, I said, it's terrible that they're so big and they're simplifying their research. My big revelation was that they're big because they simplified their research. If they had spent their time deep diving, they wouldn't be big. Because people aren't interested in actually learning.
Dude. I mean, that's a sad thing about...
It's quite a black pill, but...
It is quite the black pill. I mean, I was inside of one of Dan Locke's classes, just like, you know, checking out for research, whatever. And he's talking about how he writes his webinars. So he actually teaches how to write a webinar. And every time I see these guys, I'm like, these guys are so hardworking. Why don't you write something that's actually useful? He's there being like, here's how you... Like, he teaches you like a bullshit method of taking someone through that learning process. But it's like so much work. Like he follows us. He's basically a film writer, or like he's basically writing.
Yeah, do something productive.
Yeah, why not just do something productive? And I think Graham Stephan actually put it well in his video, saying like, let's just say I have a product that I'm making $20 million on my business. I can realize, hey, if I teach this, I can make $200 million. He was kind of saying that too, because the business that you have doing it, it has overhead, it has costs, whatever. But of course, you make it once. You put it out there and then you find some formula of like advertising and selling it. I'm not saying Graham does that, but it's true. And maybe next time we got to ask him that, like, where is that going to lead, man? Like you have someone made money doing something and then they go, I made money doing something. Here's a class on how to do it. Now I'm going to make 200 million, like 20 times more.
I think the key is you have to really do it and you have to be ethical with your pricing. I think it's really important to price your stuff appropriately. I think people go buy these courses because they think they're worth it. And in fact, they're not. They don't actually get the value they're being told they're getting. John Pearson, SEK 59. But really, I did enjoy Graham's course. I would not. I think it would be better priced at like $20. But I'm in the position where I can buy it. So it's different for a lot of other people. Wait, one second. SEK 59. Could Aristotle, Kant, or Wittgenstein have existed in a world of video content? No, I don't think they could have. I think they would have gone broke.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, today, who knows? I mean, Shakespeare, people call Shakespeare just like friends. people like, if you were alive back then, we see Shakespeare as like this great honorable guy, but back then people were like, oh yeah, it's Friends. It's like, you know,
but it was way more thoughtful. It's way more thoughtful and insightful than Friends, though. Have you ever read Shakespeare? It's like really profound. A lot of it. I mean, I'm not saying that it's, you know, some, but if you actually, if you try to read it, it's dense. It's dense.
It is dense. And sometimes I wonder if that's like language over the time, because if you look at the front row of a Shakespeare play back then, it was like the grunts, man. It was like the uneducated people sat in the front, and they were into it and they were part of it. Like they could watch it as well as the Queen and stuff like that. And a lot of our rom-coms today, we just rip Shakespeare stories. We just take the formula kind of from that, like Romeo and Juliet. Yeah. A lot of that stuff is still being used, you know? So it's like, yeah. And, you know,
do you agree with this thought? Because I have a pretty prevailing thought that I think everyone's way more informed about, they're more informed on a wider range of topics, but they're way less informed about all of those topics.
Oh, 100%. They know one thing really well.
And no, we used to know one thing really well, and then now we know everything very poorly.
Oh, yeah, yeah, we're dabbling. We're all dabbling. We're all just kind of a little bit into everything and, you know, basically doing what catches our fancy, and too many things are catching our fancy. I mean, it is a big issue right now. And then another thing with these classes, though, too, is that I've heard people say this, where it's like, okay, you got rich doing this thing. Everyone else is not going to get rich doing this thing. You know, that's a big issue. Like a lot of people, even in the self-help game where they write these books and they're like, I was here and I made it, whatever they did, even in business, they call it like blue ocean strategy versus red oceans or whatever. It's like, okay, you got rich doing that. One of the things that they all need to start teaching is that, okay, I got rich doing this thing. It's not going to work, but look at how I was thinking along the way. And yeah, also it's a lot of luck, because it's something that nobody wants to admit. Nobody wants to admit the luck.
Listen, why do we have all these professional millionaires that their job is to be a millionaire? It's kind of weird, yeah, isn't it? Like, it's like the video I was showing you before we had Graham on. He was like, it was like this video, 4X as a multimillionaire. I'm going to teach you life. It's like, and actually one of the guy's points in the video was, don't listen to your parents. Ignore your parents. Listen to me. I'm some genius 25-year-old.
The
best
is the
worst advice. How is it a job?
Your mind. College scam, everything else, not a scam. But sorry, go ahead.
It's $1 million job to be a professional millionaire on YouTube. Nobody's talking about it.
Yeah,
I'll talk about it. Nobody else talks about it. It's kind of weird. I'm gonna start calling myself a millionaire just because it makes you more money. Hey guys, I'm Steven, I'm a millionaire. I'll never prove it to you, but just please believe me. And I definitely didn't make money by saying I'm a millionaire. I made it way before. Don't ask Cal. Right?
200K subs, this guy. I wonder how he got them, right? They also teach you how to do that, scaling your channel up. Like, here's another thing that where you guys are missing out, brother. You guys, in the honest game, you don't get to do this, but like one of the ways that Alex Becker teaches to scale your channel is to, he calls it scaling the channel, because he's like, you have a course, and then the course pays for the hits on the channel. So once you got the course in place, now your channel is a profitable sales funnel. So even if you spend $1,000 advertising your channel, it's worth it, because you're going to sell, you know, one or two classes a month, and you have this product to sell. So there's a lot of it does give you these advantages, but it's always hard to be good.
Yethere are some gray areas. I think it's fine. Stephan had one good point about videos versus books. How do you get an 18-year-old to look at this info that, like, personal finance? A video is better than nothing and an entry point. I agree. I'm just saying it's a worse place to learn. If you actually want to learn, don't go to videos. But yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah.
There are great, and one of my big regrets, like, with Coffee Break is I got really cynical about educational YouTube. I still am a little bit. But I started, like, I really got bitter about the people who were doing it. And I really shouldn't be, because I should view it as like, it's a good place to start. And it's fine if people view it as like they're learning. But I feel like instead of being negative, what we should do is point people towards the good information and not, you know, I think it's fine to say that books are better, but I don't think people who create videos are bad. I create videos, you know, I think it's fine. Videos are the new medium. It's unfortunate, but like, it's true.
The classes are just tough where they tell you you'll be a millionaire if you take my class. I think that's one of my big things, is like, you're selling this class for $2,000 to clearly desperate people, and you're pushing it on them. You know, Graham's not pushing it, at least. That's good. You know,
That's where he's really ethical. I think he doesn't push it down people's throat. And that in of itself makes it much more fair, because you can go to him and you can say, I want to buy it, or I don't want to buy it. And that's much different from like a car salesman saying, this will make you rich. You need this, you need this, you need this. So it's very, very different.
And a big reason why they have this mentality of like, you can learn fast or you can learn in a second is because these guys teach them that. They're like the channel you're talking about. What is it? Woke Mill and what is it? Woke Alexander? What was his name? The guy we were talking about before? The ring he had on. This gold ring.
Oh, the Swag Academy?
Swag Academy! That's a good name though, dude.
Dude, it's a good name. It's hot. And he starts every video with gang gang!
Gang gang! Oh wow. Swag Academy. Gang, gang. Of course, Swag Academy. Yeah, dude. What a beauty.
Graham just uploaded LMAO. Dude. Graham's crushing it. Yeah. Dude, good he is. Hey, he got off the live stream, he's uploading. I honestly, you guys can learn a lot from Graham Stephan. I'm telling you, it's very true. I'm a little behind on the live stream, but I've learned a lot from Graham Stephan. His channel has opened my eyes to the world of finance. I have gone on to read books from there. And that's the best you can hope for. Thank you, Muhammad. That is the best you can hope for. Wow.
Did you read this Gurgic one, the $5 Gurgic chat?
No, what he says. Sorry, I missed
that. People love packaged info that makes them feel smart. It's actually addictive so much, it makes it hard to read. Less dopamine rush.
Guys, if you don't have an internet blocker on your phone and you don't have a plan to stop social media addiction, you're not doing things right. Sorry to say, everybody's addicted to their phones. You better have some plan. I do. I'm not
a
saint.
I got Focus Me. You know Focus Me? Mm-mm. It's a new thing that you can get that basically blocks a bunch of sites.
Yeah.
I just got it. I didn't pay for it yet. I got a 1 month trial.
Ones where you can control like when you have access to sites. So like I'll block YouTube, Instagram, all that stuff. I never have it on my phone. It was one of my year goals. I completely eliminated all social media from my phone. I don't have it. It's why when I went live, I didn't know because I didn't have access to my phone. So I couldn't have known. but then on my other stuff, I'll control, like, I don't get on those sites from like 9 to 5 roughly. And it's like, it's just automatically, I cannot, I've limited myself. I cannot get on them.
That's great. That's great. So what program do you use to block that?
Freedom. On your phone, you and then also you can use the Google Wi-Fi mesh to control internet access during certain times.
Okay.
You kind of got to do a mixture if you're really going to
do a
mix.
But have you heard of Covenant Eyes? Covenant Eyes. Have you heard of them? Covenant Eyes.
Yeah, that's the porn one, right?
That's a porn one.
Wait. We're supposed to keep this PG. Remember
Covenant Eyes. Covenant. We're talking about Covenant. Actually, this is I feel like PG, that one doesn't work well. Like, does yours? You work like there? Like, how does yours work though? Just tell me how yours works. It blocks those sites.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's not called the Freedom Platform. It's called Freedom. It's on your iPhone,
right?
And you set like block lists and when you want it to be blocked. It's great.
Right. Only reason they bring up Covenant Eyes is because they record your screen and then they send you a screenshot of like, hey, you were looking at this. Whereas people have said that it slows down their computer. So that's why I never got that.
I don't know.
That's kind of a scam. But their documentaries were good, man. They had these documentaries about addiction, whatever.
Coffeezilla, my work is reading new scientific publications and to write and transfer the knowledge in understandable bundles. So I agree with you, but the new medium offers so much interaction. It's just surface level. It's just people aren't really actually getting what you're like saying. That's the problem. You sacrifice. There is a sweet spot, but every time you make an attempt to be way more entertaining and simplify it, you're slashing at someone's ability to understand. So you gain a wider audience, but that audience understands less. I mean, like, look at like the super successful like science channels. Most of it is entertainment at this point. Like, look at like Mark Rober, and it's fine. It's fine because I said, I'm trying to be more positive.
You don't believe in valuetainment?
No, I'm trying to be more positive. Hold on. So I get it. He's getting people like interested, and hopefully they go read the books. But the problem is when all you're doing is watching like I freaking love science videos. You're not actually doing or understanding science. Okay, let's be honest. So I think you can get addicted to the entertainment is my point. I mean, you're not actually educating yourself.
One of the things they're teaching in Buddhist meditation too, where they're saying like, whether it's spicy food or very like hot, like spicy food or sugary food or like very like flashy in like videos in front of you, what you're doing, you're addicting yourself to requiring more dopamine. This is like a big thing. And they say so reading is a good exercise to give yourself concentration, to focus on one idea at a time.
Right.
I mean, it's a good skill, man. People should do it. It'll make you like stronger, I think, smarter.
Yeah. I mean, it's just something we should be telling everyone. I'm shocked that there isn't like a class in school about this. Like your phone is a Skinner box. It will addict you to it. That's what it's designed to do. Every app is trying to keep you on there longer. So have a game plan. Don't be stupid. You know, have a game plan.
It's almost like the gurus have their pyramid scheme. And then above all of them is the YouTube. it is the YouTube algorithm, and they're also just like, hey, your last video, you know, you did this. Like, you guys were talking about the analytics today.
They're literally trading you to make more addictive videos. That's what they're doing.
They're training you. Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah. They're saying, hey, you're
also better videos, but yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Coffeezilla, have you seen this Netflix documentary, The Social Dilemma? I didn't watch it because I feel like I've kind of had a lot of these thoughts already. My guess is it's going to repeat a lot of what I sort of...
It's going to make you more angry and more sad.
Yeah.
I mean, it's basically sad, dire and sad issue that we're talking about. It tells you, Stephen, when you watch that documentary, you're going to be like, oh, it's 10 times worse than I thought. That's what that documentary is. Like, we all know it's bad.
No, I'm
black. And then
black.
The documentary's like, no, it goes way
further. I'm already black-pilled. I got black-pilled. Right. Late coffee break days. That's when I got black-pilled.
Right.
And actually, I started feeling bad talking to other educators. I was talking to one educator, and I was just telling him my opinion of education. And later, a friend of his called me, and they go, hey, why'd you discourage like this person from doing education YouTube? I said, I didn't discourage him. I just told him what I thought. He like, I black-pilled him. So I said, I'm going to start keeping these thoughts to myself. And I didn't talk about it till really today.
Right. Yeah, no, but it... Like, dude, you know, you go too deep into an issue and then you get to the meaning of life, man. I'm telling you, you're going to get to a point where you go, okay, what, like, with this, where's the line of what's a scam and what's not a scam? Let's just say with videos. It is a tough spot to nail down. You know what I mean? It's hard to nail it down. I don't know. I don't know exactly where it is. And then same thing with, like, educating people. It's like, at what point do you start saying, okay, YouTube, you're not allowed to do this anymore? You were getting into some leftist stuff, brother. You're talking about YouTube.
No. Freedom of speech is different from what I'm talking about here with education. Mm-hmm. I think people and young people just need to hear that their phone habits, while common and normal, are bad, right? Everyone does it, but it's bad for your brain.
For sure.
And you can actually to get ahead in life, you just have to do what nobody else is doing. And when everyone else is just watching Netflix all day and on their phone all day, it's pretty easy to get ahead.
Turn it off.
Yeah.
Turn it off.
Just turn
but
it
it's
off.
Built to make you addicted to it. And that's what that documentary is about.
And you
it's
don't have to be like go from alcoholic to sober. Like, I'm not saying don't unplug social media, but you've got to understand that your current balance, probably everyone in this chat's current balance is bad. Unless
it's bad. And look, you guys are the kind of people that already get suckered into some pyramid scheme stuff, right? So you think these Instagrams aren't locking you in and they're not screwing you? They're getting you too. It's true, man. I mean, that's what that whole documentary is about. It's very, like, they are the back engine of all these pyramid schemes, if you think about it. I mean, they're, you know, not to be negative, that is very negative, but, like, they are operating on a very, like, it's very abusive what they're doing. They're very, it is, like, messed up. I mean, that's what the documentary. It's a, you should check it out. It goes through, like, all the science of it. Everything's great. But it's all stuff that you already know, basically.
Right. And it's,
yeah, it's true.
But it's also inevitable in a machine where, growth is the mandate, right? You've always got to grow, and the only way to grow is to be competitive, and the only way to be competitive is to take more of people's time, and the only way to take more of people's time is to make it simpler, make it dumber, make it more addicting. And so the people, like, you end up finding out, oh, the people don't want to learn. Like, actually, most people don't want to learn. Most people want to be addicted to their phone. Most people want to take the easy way out. And it's like, you know, that's a hard truth you have to kind of grapple with. Are you trying to kill your whole audience? What are you talking about? No. I'd like to come on your show. How does one do that? You can come back on a day where we do the Discord calls.
Yeah, yeah. Limbic capitalism. Someone called it limbic capitalism, Stephen. This is a very hard leftist stuff that maybe you don't want to hear. But
no,
limbic capitalism, they basically talk about how we are, whether it's food or internet or whatever it is, they're like, we all need to be hooked on a couple of things in order to keep this system running. How do we keep this system running? We got to be buying the chips. We got to be buying, like, it is a part of, like, how it's a big part of our economy, and it's something that I think we're figuring out now. Like, we got to shift and change a lot of people's maybe way of thinking, because it is bankrupting us a little bit. Let's say with junk food, for sure bankrupting us. But then, like, what these guys are saying about Facebook and where that goes, like, that really is basically is leading down everyone to a divisive path too.
Well, but here's the thing, people are going to get sick of it, and they're going to start talking like me. And then they're going to eventually unplug, and then platforms will, there will be a sub market for people who realize the bad effects of social media. You already see it with companies coming out and offering these services.
Yeah.
And, you know, there are really good people out there who want to do good things, and they will do those things. It's just, you know.
Do you listen to Tim Dillon at all?
Yeah, I love Tim Dillon. He's great.
So did you hear his episode this week with Candace Owens?
He did a video with Candace Owens? Hilarious.
He did a full episode of Candace Owens. It was honestly, I was like so on her side. I was like, yeah, this is reasonable. She's like, man, my, you know, like I just believe in freedom of speech and my family does this or whatever. And then she starts talking about her beliefs and I'm just like, it's wild. It's like such an internet rabbit hole. Like she believes in like, she's like, Trump's going to take back the election, by the way. Also the leftists are trying to attack us on this. Like she has all of those things. And I feel like it comes from being in this like internet rabbit hole a little bit too.
Well, there's an internet rabbit hole both ways.
And yeah, there is.
Everybody just thinks, everybody's just in their own echo chamber and they just believe what's being fed to them all the time. Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah.
Coffeezilla, like, yeah, it is crazy how we no longer share the same facts. Like people just, on both sides of the aisle, we don't believe the same things.
So social
media, Facebook
too,
is
right?
A big monopoly. Something must be done. Big tech in general is. Dan Locke, more like Dan Suck. Okay. Jurgic, okay. I'm hooked on keeping Coffeezilla running. Thanks, guys. You know, if you guys like this kind of content, you know, subscribe to The Drip because The Drip's not going to be here for very long. Graham Stephan says
I can't believe
you're
killing us. The live stream's killing us.
he said these guys are killing us. We love you guys. Don't listen to
No, we love the live stream. I always thought that YouTube just loves the live stream, though. I always thought everyone's trying to get in the live stream game. So they're like, oh, you're doing live stream? Okay, cool. Whatever else you're doing, great. Let's put some love on the live stream. That's what I always thought everyone's platform mentality was.
No.
But I guess
no.
YouTube doesn't like the live streams.
I guess not. Love this channel. Any updates on the Ponzinomics book? Very excited for it. I think it's on Amazon. Look it up on Amazon. I'm pretty sure it's live. I do content creative work in a lot of gurus in the space who are good people. Is there a way that I can address, expose the nonsense in this niche like you do without getting blacklisted? I don't know. I find your question to be kind of a little bit weird. I don't know
who
you're talking about.
They're gonna come after you.
Cutthroat. Yeah, but basically this space has an obsession with positivity because people are obsessed with growth. And so they know if they're always positive, they'll always grow. And so there's no game in calling people out. I mean, I guess we've kind of created one with this community, but it's very unique. There's not much of a game in calling people out. So no, I don't think there's a way to
the
call
money's
people
in
out.
The positivity. To,
if you call people out within the industry, you're going to get blacklisted. I think that's how it goes. Yeah.
And it's not only blacklisted. It's like the money's in the course, brother. The money, that is the test from God. How do you make money? How do you grow without using that stuff? Because a lot of them are teaching like, hey, like Alex Becker's class. He's like, if you don't have a class, how are you going to scale? Doesn't make sense. He's like, don't even bother. His YouTube class is start a course or like sell someone else's course.
Yeah, but to a hammer, everything's a nail. Amish, of course, he thinks that you have to sell a course. He sells courses. I don't even think he does anymore. Somebody was saying, I'm interested in learning any good channels in learning about anything. Life Connoisseur, I don't know if you just listened to my whole rant, but I think you should read books, right? Go find a talk. I'm also not going to tell you what book to read. Go find a book. Go to your local library. Look around. Find something interesting that you want to watch.
Okay. Do you have a course on that that'll teach me how to do that?
Hey, there's a book I just lent my brother called How to Read a Book.
Oh, there you go.
Think about it. It's actually it's unironically good though.
We gotta write a book called How to Stop Being a Sheep and Think for Yourself. That's the that's the real lesson.
And then the first lesson is, all right, it's clear to me that you are a sheep because you bought this course. You failed already, but that's okay. By the end of this course, we'll offer you an upsell, and if you buy it, you failed again, and we'll have to reteach you. It's back to square one. Like that's the upsell.
Yep. But you just have to keep taking their money and you go, what are you idiots thinking? I feel like Dan Lok does that a little bit.
Coffeezilla, what do you think of Big Mark? Oh my gosh. Are you talking about this guy?
Who's Big Mark?
He's like this weird guy who all he does is, well, I don't want to say weird, but all he does is make how to make money videos on YouTube that none of them work. And he's just doing it because it's the right niche. There's no,
That's nice. I like you're like, hey, I don't want to say he's not a cool guy, but he is a con artist.
Human. There's a lot of these guys that are, they're cool. You know, they're cool guys otherwise, but then they do stupid stuff.
Oh yeah. Look at Max Torno. Max Torno, very cool dude, man. He's rock and roll. And even Spencer gave him a positive review. Max Torno, he sells like a business class. He was a pickup artist. Now he's in the business game.
Oh my God.
I mean, he's moving away from the pickup. They're all moving away.
And
that's
selling
a big rebranding.
Course. That's not a good move. Roberto Blake, Victor, thanks, but learn from doing more content like I did, learn more camera work. Yeah, Roberto Blake's right, dude. You've got to just do it. You know what it's like, Amish? It's like watching the NFL all day long and expecting to become a good basketball player. Hey, sorry, you can watch Mr. Beast all day. You can study him, and it's fine. I think it's important if you're going to learn something to study who's good, but nothing, and I mean nothing, replaces just going and doing it.
Yeah, rip and dip a little bit. So you get a sense of what it's like and like what you have to do. There are, you do have to write the bits for it. Like you want to have some topics ready. You want to have some bits ready. And then, yeah, like it's, you're basically at working like a TV writer from 1990s, 2000s. Like you look at Johnny Carson's TV writers, right? They're all asking the same questions. They're like, how do we, what bit do we do? How do we get more hits? That's a $1 million question, man. I ask people in TV, I ask people like veterans of TV. It's like, hey, what should I do for on my YouTube channel? Like, what's a good, what, how do I write my bits or whatever? And they go,
nobody knows.
I wish I knew.
Well, the people who are right, like you have the sauce or you don't. And the way you get the sauce is by practicing.
And everyone will discourage you. Everyone will be like, well, it's not going to work. Just stop it. Like, it is tough.
Coffeezilla, have you noticed a big trend on big YouTube channels doing what's already done on TV? Think Mr. Beast equals game show. Do you think a TV show could work on YouTube? Yeah, I think like more programming, like being smarter about it. It makes sense.
That's where it's going. This is going to be the new TV. I mean, what's Netflix? I mean,
hey guys, Netflix. y'all want a little treat here? Should I show them a little treat? Can I show y'all? I have a sneak peek of the $10 million studio. I want to show you guys.
Give them the magic.
This is fire. Okay, I'm not even gonna lie to you guys. This is so fire. Don't tell anybody about this because I only want 700 people to see it because I want it to be a surprise for everyone else. I've never showed anyone this, boys. Ready? Three. Hold on. Let's get some different music on. This music sucks. Hold on, guys. Let's build the suspense a little bit, all right? To answer your question about could there be a show that was like TV, but maybe even better, to that, all I have to say is this. Woo!
Internet detective.
Woo!
It's a shame.
Ah, that's all you get.
That's all you're going to give him.
That's it.
Woo. Oh, my God. Woo. Calvin Nguyen, $3.99. He said, give him $3.99. He said, goddamn, it's beautiful. Give him $3.99.
Boys, we're gonna take over, boys. That's how we're taking over. The production value. It's coming. The $10 million studio. It's big coming. Studio.
Yeah. Yeah, no. I'm working on my digital ashram. We just got the location. I told you it's on an Electron. We've got a location. Digital ashram.
You guys are not ready, dude. Y'all aren't ready for it. We're leveling up the game. We're leveling up the personal finance world, the guru world. We're leveling up the Coffeezilla army. We're going where no man has gone before. It's so next level.
Yeah, yeah. But dude, great point he also brought up about, he's like, they're begging me to teach a class. That's a tough one. That's one where I was like, well, you know what? They said, please, Graham, please. Baba, Graham, please teach me.
Dude, people are saying live's fun for us. I know, that's why I really don't like Graham's advice. I get it, but I don't know. I might just have to live stream anyway for the people. I don't know.
Pure analytics,
you guys have
right?
to go we'll subscribe, get there. Look. Subscribe to the drip. Okay, so just in case we decide that we have to go there. But it's sexy, boys. It's sexy.
Yeah.
We need to look at what the people are saying, dude. People goes, that's all I needed. Hot, that was good. Blue balls. The production value phases through the door. Yeah, dude. Absolutely.
Coffee's becoming a virtual YouTuber now. Patrick Bateman. Patrick Bateman's a regular. Right?
We'll see. Patrick, you'll have to find out. Oh, I do things that are bad for the channel all the time because I can't help myself, and that's what I'd like. Roberto Blake. Yeah, dude, sometimes you got to do that. This thing I spent, I have no idea whether this investment, and like really it's time investment too, like setting all this stuff up. I don't know if it's worth it, but I'm doing it because it's what I love. It's what I would want to see on a YouTube channel. And so that's what I want. I don't just want to be one of those guys who hops on the trends. I want to be someone who creates things that I'd like to see, creates some kind of an art thing, you know?
Yeah.
I love it.
You're making art. You gotta make that art. The ROI is infinite when you're making art. It's like, it's, you know, you just try stuff. You learn it. You learn as you go too. I mean, you can't just be like an analytics robot too. Come on. That's like a slavery almost. It's like, they're not like Noah Keegan's channel.
You're right.
We were like,
you're right.
You're watching the channel. You're like, baby, live a little. What does Noah want?
I love that.
I know
what
the algorithm is.
Live a little, Noah.
Live
Come
a little
on,
bit.
Noah.
Let's see a little bit of you shine. Let's see some of the Lord's favor shine through
you.
Not
doing?
Just this algorithm this, algorithm that. Yeah, I know. No, Noah, and he does videos about it. He explains it. He's like, well, I started noticing my.
So I'm hacking my analytics. I'm hackalytics. Dude, again, it'll get you the audience, but who's going to stay around for that? I don't stay. Like, honestly. Sometimes I respect the analytics grind so much, and I'm like, dude, what a genius for doing it this way. And I understand what they're doing, but then I'm like, but at what cost? You're creating videos for babies, basically. It's like a lot of the training content is like, this is for babies, for like 9-year-olds. I want to create videos for adults. I don't know.
Hey man, I mean, you know, my buddy, this comic, we were talking about like owning real estate, and he was just saying, this guy, Calvin Shergold, great guy, great comic out of Toronto. And he goes, Amish, this whole life is a rental. So like, you don't own real estate. You just get to have it while you're alive, and then you die and then it's gone or whatever. It's like, if you're doing this analytics game, right? It's almost like you're just spending all your time being like, what do other people want? And it's like, you're supposed to live for you a little bit. You know, so even with real estate, it's like you own the house for every moment you lived in the house. It's effectively yours. Nobody owns anything forever. But even you're like there is something about time, right? Like, I mean, you're going to spend hours and hours going through analytics. It's like you're here to be you. Like the thing.
It's just
that
a different game, though, I feel like. Those people are running their business, their channels as a business. And I still have a hard time doing that. I mean, I still want to run it. You need to have the business side, you need to have the art side too. I feel like that's what made me get into YouTube. And I don't ever want to lose that, where I get to the point where the only reason I'm doing something, like you said, I'm just in the analytics all day. And I'm just like, because then you guys on here, like, you guys are people. You guys aren't numbers on a screen. Yeah. That's what analytics reduces you to, is like, you're literally just a number to me. And then I don't have any connection to you. You don't have any connection to me. I'm just literally appealing to the mass.
It's like, sorry, YouTube, we're saving lives, YouTube. Sorry, YouTube, that your algorithm is behind. Catch up to us. We're saving lives over here.
Well,
I mean, these people are going to join a cult.
It's just the long play, dude. It's just the long play. We're going long play. We're not doing the short term
thing.
And it's the interaction with Steven, Amish, and the community that made me stay. Mark Yagan. Yeah, dude, that's why we like this is some of my favorite times. I like having on guests, but like sometimes just hanging out with chat.
Yeah, chat is great, man. I love our chat. I love our audience. They're cool. They're like, you know why they're vulnerable? I feel like they all got ripped off. Like all of them got ripped off, and they're like, I feel like, okay, you know, I'm around people that admit it at least.
Arrow Kiwi, what number am I? You're not a number to me, buddy.
You're not a number.
Or at least I try not to be that way. It's hard to not be that way sometimes, but I try to avoid it. I tried to, you know, not do that. And that's what I tell every YouTuber that I run across, because I'm not the most knowledgeable YouTuber, but I have realized the stupidity of the game. And a lot of YouTubers think that the game is all there is, and it's not. Coffeezilla, what does analytics research entail? Well, you go into your analytics page and you look at watch time, click-through rate, and you only make creative decisions based on that. That's what Graham was talking to us about. Is you make creative decisions based on what your analytics tell you to do. So you basically become, you're trying to mimic your biggest part of your audience. You're basically making content only for the biggest part of your audience and never for the people who actually want to learn something or like go deep.
Yeah. Roberto Blake texted me too during the show. Right? Roberto Blake's like looking out for us.
Yeah,
Roberto's looking out for us. He texted me. He goes, hey, the internet's cutting out, some glitches, whatever. Audio is back now. He's texting me.
What a sweet guy, dude. I've really become a big fan of Roberto Blake. He's not like a fair weather friend. He's like, he actually is in the community. He's a real part of it. Really good guy.
We gotta bring him back. I want to take his class now.
Yeah, we had a good
his class must be great.
We had a good time with him. Coffeezilla, is there such a thing as a legit good guru? Guys, let me tell you. There are courses that are scams, outright scams, right? Total, like, they're just, the guy doesn't do what he says he does. But then there are courses that are just not worth the money, because we've come to a place in course selling where they're charging outrageous sums of money for what is essentially a book, right?
Yeah,
so
we need a system.
If a book is $500, I'm not going to call it a scam. I'm just going to say, don't buy it at $500. But somehow when we sell courses for that, it's a course. And we're not even talking about personalized coaching, by the way. We're talking about like 8 hours of video, which is the equivalent of a book. It doesn't make sense. So I tell people, never buy a course. Look, if it's under $100, I guess it's fine. I mean, like, I'm not going to say it can't be worth it for you. But for most people, most of the time, don't buy anything over $20. That's what I tell you. And if you don't buy it, the gurus will have to follow you guys. They'll have to pay that price. So
it's,
I don't know.
It's hard to tell where the lines are. I mean, honestly, we might have to start a class. Quite frankly, we might honestly have to start a class and be like, look, what's the ROI on the course?
Amish,
is he promising you $1 million?
How much Alex Becker did you watch this week? Just tell me. Don't feel bad about it. No. It's okay. Just tell me.
Oh, dude, I'm watching other gurus now. I've seen too many. I'm in Vince Del Monte's. I'm watching Vince Del Monte's sales church.
Oh my gosh, dude.
I'm in Vince Del Monte's sales church. It's amazing. Actually, dude, this guy in Toronto.
Sales church. Wow.
I call it sales church because he does a prayer off the top and then they do the whole thing. Yeah, it's great. It's beautiful.
Oh my gosh, they believe
in something, man. Sean Kennel, too.
Good for them. They believe
Sean Kennel, too. Dude, at Sean Kennel's live event, they brought a priest to come do something.
I just think it's funny that you're like, you really. Yeah, you're a great. You're the perfect co-host, Amish, because you believe in the gurus a little bit, and it's a good balance. It's funny to me.
You're like Amish. It's good that you're here because you're very naive, and the people need to relate to that. Someone needs to relate to this. Someone very naive.
No, it's like good cop, bad cop.
Maybe you could make a million.
It's the good cop, bad cop. When I'm being nice, you call people Hitler. When you're being nice, I call it a scam. Jorge Ronas.
Yeah, interesting.
What was it like with all the $5? What was it like when all the conspiracy theories descended on you for the David Icke video? Did you poop your pants a little? No. So I don't feel bad when I feel right about the subject and people disagree. I have no problem being disagreeable. You guys should know that about me by now. I don't have a problem disagreeing with the majority of people. I have made mistakes, which I've gotten flack for, which are different, where I've apologized. That's a different kind of situation. But David Icke, I was right. So I don't feel bad.
Yeah, no, it's fine.
Or I think I was right. You can have a different opinion. Coffee and Amish, have you seen Behezia on Graham podcast? What's your thoughts on it? Fake or legit drop shipping? Look, guys, I talked to a guy who's legitimately making seven figures selling $2 bills, and he drop ships them. Now, at home, you might be thinking, oh, great, I'm going to run out and drop ship. These people have spent years on this. This is a decade. Look, any business, in fact, it doesn't matter who you're talking about. The problem with courses is they tell you they're gonna shortcut your 10 years. Nobody will. So some of these opportunities, you can make money in Forex. You're just not gonna make it in 2 years or 4 years or 5 years. And you're not gonna make the amount they tell you. You're gonna start. And you may, I mean, it's not even a guarantee, but 10 years.
No, you make 10,000, you'll lose 20,000, you'll make 2,000.
Put 10 years in, dude.
All over the place, man.
So that kind of stuff, I feel like you can't call stuff outright a scam. The opportunity, you can call the courses a scam, but not the opportunities. Usually there's some truth to it, but it's way less profitable than people think.
It is tough. And what they don't tell you, what these gurus don't tell you is they don't tell you like how to have their cutthroat mentality maybe. And they try to teach that at Vince Del Monte's seven-figure mastermind class, by the way. They do try to teach you that. They do the prayer, but then they have like, here's how you take someone through a sales process. Part one is called prison. It's like, this is their life sucks. You got to dig into that. Why are you sad? Why are you messed up? Like, you got to go into their pain.
Yeah, you want to abuse it. And you want to use their pain against them to sell them.
Yeah. take them to the promised land that is buying your product. I mean.
Oh my gosh. What?
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard to fight against these people. They work so hard though. That's the thing. You look at PBD, you go, man, this guy's doing his YouTube channel's popping, and he's got a PHP on the side, or an MLM on the side,
and
whatever it is.
And he's running a pyramid scheme. Yeah, sure. Okay.
That is work ethic, though. You know what I'm saying? It's so much work.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Look at Bernie Madoff. Oh, I'm not saying it's the same. I shouldn't say that, but like, it's true.
Time will tell, man.
It's hard to admire like someone running a business model that I find to be fraudulent. It's hard to admire someone. I don't.
It's tough.
It's not tough. It's not tough for me.
It's tough seeing his great videos and then seeing, oh, but you run an MLM thing. You know what I mean? Like, that makes me sad. I'm like, man, PBD can do anything.
Read Diego Cutie's comment. I love this.
Diego Cutie, where are you at? Diego? Where's Diego Cutie?
I'm pointing to it on the call.
Oh, shoot. Okay, cool. Everything will go great on the drip till Scammy she gets on the discovery call with Becker and gets hired.
They're going to see you. They're going to poach you. And they're going to be like, hey, we'll give you real money and we'll pay you under the table. No taxes needed.
Look, if he gets on the call, I sell him on coming on the show. That's
okay.
It.
Honestly, Amish, answer this question honestly.
Tell me.
How much would it take for a guru to pay you to where you switch to their side?
Oh,
you quit the show. No, that's not true. How much? Give me a number.
What, like Dan Locke?
Yeah, like say Dan Locke comes to you, they go, hey, you're giving Coffeezilla too many hits. You're too popular. I want you to be on my side. What's your This is good. What's your
this
price?
This is good because I do. Is that what happened to Kevin Hart? Maybe, or like, what do you think? Like, do you think those guys that are going to Grand Cardone or whatever?
All these guys see an amount of money, big money, and they see how much money they're making. They go, well, I could pitch a course.
Hey, they're like, stand-up's dried up. Hey, how about selling my real estate class? that pays $20,000 no matter what the economy. I mean, yeah, I don't think I could do that, knowing what I know. And I'm not blaming Kevin Hart. I think he doesn't know. You know what I mean?
$1 million, Amish. I don't know if I'd be insulted that you didn't take it.
Oh yeah, $1 million. But I tell you, like, nope, nothing would change my mind. I tell you, right.
But you have to at some point. The way it would change your life would be too valuable to me. And like, no, like, because I want you to be successful as a person, I'd almost be like, well, Amish, I mean, it's a lot of money. You'd be like, no, Stephen, I believe too strongly. I'd be like, Amish, you got to take the money.
Take the money.
Okay, but I'd say under 500K, no way, go long game.
Right.
Over 500K to $1 million, especially if it's $1 million, $2 million, take the money, Amish. We'll have you back. Money. We'll get you a non-compete for 3 years. You'll come back in 3 years.
And then come back in 3 years. But you know what? God is so great that God would never give you that. Like, you know, like it would, right now we would only get an under 500,000 offer. You see, the Lord only gives you what you can handle. Nobody's going to come to me with a $10 million offer.
Beyond what you can bear, Amish.
Yeah, there's no temptation beyond what we can bear.
Oh, I don't. Yeah, so we'll see.
Who's going to come with $2 million right now? They're going to come with like 10,000. They're going to come and be like, "Hey, sell them out, and then we can do a podcast together." Dude, they are such con artists. They'll never give you the money. They're so full of it. They'd come and be like, "Hey, let's start our own podcast and we'll grow it. Don't worry."
Oh yeah, I've seen these guys, and nobody's watching these guys. Yeah, no, nobody's watching them because there's nothing to learn. Has Amish started a comedy YouTube channel yet? He's got one, but he needs to upload more.
I knew you need to upload more. I'm working on my first meditation videos and my first reaction video. I have a diss video on Alex Becker. I don't want to say too much about it. I just want to finish it, and we'll see it.
Sweet, dude. Well, is it? It's a love letter to Alex Becker, or is
it's
it
a diss video?
Okay.
He insulted the community.
All right.
The manifestation community. He insulted the manifestation community, and I have some words to say about it.
Oh, okay. Raven fan. Yeah. Coffeezilla opinion on Jordan Belfort. I find it weird when people, like, he's selling a stock picking course. I think that's absolutely insane.
But the
this
sales
guy
training.
Was on film.
Yeah.
He's got a movie about him committing stock fraud. And you're telling me he's the guy to listen to about stock picks?
Jordan Belfort.
What are we
talking
about?
Made a movie.
He's got the mind of the wolf with Raging Bull. What?
He's a wolf of Wall Street. Don't do business with this guy.
How?
What do you need?
Yeah, learn to sell like a con artist. Fine. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
But learn stocks? No, I can't.
Okay, Jordan Belfort has a lot of sales training, though.
What I'm saying. Learn to, like, he's a good salesman. Yeah. Legitimately.
No, that's a good call.
He's a good salesman, but why would you go to? Yeah, I don't know.
No, don't do a stock picking class.
Have a course on how to avoid stock picks, like stock scams. He ran the scam. That's it.
He did run the scam. But that's how that's the main credibility. They come back and they go, "Oh, I can teach you how to make sure you don't get scammed now." Hey, I'm Jordan Belfort. I ran the biggest stock scam of the century. Now let me teach you how to not get scammed. I mean, that's what happened to Catch Me If You Can. Remember that guy? He was like ripping everyone off, and then they made him the FBI consultant.
Yeah. Well, he was he's so good that they're like, well, yeah, actually, teach us what you're doing. Coffeezilla, what's your thoughts on James Altucher? Do you think he's a con artist? He's a hedge fund manager, for those of you who don't know. He sold a course through Agora, for those of you who don't know. Okay. I talked to him, actually, because I called him a con. He DM'd me. He said, tell me why you think I'm a con. I said, here's the reasons. And I wrote him a long list.
He goes,
I disagree with you. I said, why? I won't get into specific. There were things we talked that were like actually private, but I can tell you his argument. I don't think he would care. His argument was, you have to be a little Machiavellian in this world to get ahead. In other words, good guys finish last. Therefore, I'm going to be bad and tell people good things. And I said, if you do bad things to try to achieve good things, you're going in the wrong direction. Millions of lives. I'm not saying he's doing this, but millions of lives have been mercilessly slain because of the ends justify the means argument. It's a terrible argument. It leads to terrible wars, terrible things. It's a bad thing. And I told him, look, it's not even true. Like, you look at Joe Rogan, he's not conning people.
Yeah, true.
And he's super successful. Good guys do not finish last. It's not even true. So I was like, I tried to tell him that. And basically he goes, no, what? People don't listen to me unless I tell them they're going to get rich with my stock advice. But my stock advice is good. And I say, but if you tell people they're going to get rich and then they don't get rich and they achieve a tiny return, not good.
That's not good. But also, he's got a point with this. Look at these guru, like these fake guru, anti-fake guru. anti-fake guru people were at, you know, we're hovering in the hundreds of thousands. And then the actual fake gurus, they're all in the millions, dude. They're killing it. They have no, there is early on, it's easier to be bad. Yeah. It's like Fargo. Have you ever seen Fargo? Fargo is like an Old Testament story. It's like so beautiful. Like,
oh my gosh, Amish. I'm finally ready to confront you on this.
Tell me.
You've been to, if anyone knows the drip, if you guys know the drip, you know that every single week, Amish brings up Fargo. Every week. Every week. Every week. For months, you've been bringing up Fargo. To the point.
What's up? You didn't like it? Maybe I talked about it too much.
I watched the film so that I could relate to you better. I said, okay. Amish is my co-host. Amish is my friend. I will watch Fargo. So help me.
Okay.
So I put on Fargo. Okay.
Here we go.
Let's bring Fargo up, okay? I thought it was a series. It's a movie. Okay, I didn't know
there's
that.
There's three seasons now just made for US Network, USA Network, and they're incredible. And they all have huge actors. They're beautiful.
Oh, my gosh. Are you talking about Fargo, the show?
The TV show, yeah. But it's based on the movie. Dude, the message is the same. Like, the TV shows are they took the movie and they said, let's make it into a TV show. That's fine.
The movie sucks.
Come on.
It's like trash.
It? Oh, my God.
I was expecting all these great messages, all these incredible twists.
Try the TV, maybe. I don't
so
know.
So bad. No, I'm now seeing there's a four-season TV show. I was looking for the TV show. I guess Netflix maybe only has, or I just saw the movie?
Dude. Like, it's a groundbreaking movie, and it's a groundbreaking TV.
Oh, my gosh. The movie. So are you talking about the one with the pregnant cop?
Yeah. You don't like it? It's a classic, dude. Coen Brothers, classic movie.
Where's this story of morality and redemption and all this, like, and the bad guy? Like, what are we talking about?
We're talking about, if you look at her character and if you look at the lead character in all the Fargo TV series, it's basically the way that show works.
No, talk to me about the movie, because you defended, I'll watch the show, but talk to me about the movie. You're defending the movie.
The movie's tight. She basically has to be perfect. And then all the bad guys, they get away with doing all the bad stuff or whatever, but she has to
have
like a tight morality. You don't think she has a good morality in it?
No, I think she does, but there's not a struggle. Like, you made it sound like she's struggling with her morality and all this stuff. She's just a cop being a law enforcement officer. I didn't think it was like a story of her morality.
Maybe that's more TV show.
You know what
maybe
people would love?
Show. But you didn't like at the end of the movie, she goes, all that for a little bit of money. Don't you know that money's not everything when she arrests the giant?
Yeah, it's beautiful. Then the giant doesn't say anything. He's not persuaded. He's just like...
No, he goes to jail for
this. And then the cops are rolling down the street and it's like, okay... What's this movie? What is this movie? I don't...
Wow, you didn't like Fargo. I don't know what to tell you.
Well, no.
It's like a bang.
Okay,
dude.
It's one of those things like where you get the almost. You hype it up too much, and then like it can't live up to the expectation. I'm going to watch the show, though. Do people like hearing us talk about movies and stuff? I think that'd be like a funny segment, is like us disagreeing about movies and stuff like
that. I mean,
that.
Dude, even for Coffeezilla, though, you got to love the William H. Macy car salesman. I mean, he's so good. He's just like, no, 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 you got to get the undercoating. The undercoating is everything.
The true coat. You got to get the true coat. Yeah, that was funny. But that was, again, you made it sound like it's this grand epic on morality. It's this big statement that they make. It's just a classic story.
TV
with
show
like,
more.
The TV show. I'm
going
to watch the
TV show. We're going 10 episodes and it gets biblical, man. I mean, people like.
Yeah, where's the biblical part? I don't see that either. You're like, it gets biblical, Stephen. I'm thinking locusts. I'm thinking frogs.
The TV show has frogs.
Tundra.
The TV show does. They do the frogs too. It's so tight. The TV show, like the TV show, they do the. Oh, maybe I shouldn't hype it up too much. But they have the frogs. I think first season. I'm talking about Wrath of God frogs. They have it.
I'm
and
gonna watch
have,
the show. Let's not talk about the show anymore.
Let's not go into
it.
Check it out. It is a slow burner. But it is like very much a lot of con artists going to a small town and just roping people in. But there's so much
I didn't know. Why was he taking the money? I mean, it wasn't very clear. Like, there's something about a parking lot. Who is the friend?
Yeah.
Who is the friend? It's never explained.
Honestly,
who's
the
giant? What happened to the money? Nothing's explained, Amish.
I don't know.
You know the money?
The
all the money that's
the movie,
buried but... with like a marker? It's never resolved.
Because it doesn't matter. It's gone.
Scam.
It's gone.
I'm calling it right now. Fargo is a...
No, the TV
scam.
Show, it gets biblical. It's beautiful. I mean, the movie, I don't know. I haven't seen it in a while, but it is tight. It's a legit movie. What are we talking about here? Coen Brothers.
I'm sorry. I don't know. I'm not a...
I don't mind. I don't mind. I feel bad. I feel bad that you didn't like it. Check TV show. TV show has the biblical stuff, though.
All right, I'll check it out.
It's an FX show too. I feel like they won a bunch of Emmys.
I don't care what they won.
You don't care about the Emmys?
No. Why? It's like the Streamies. I mean, people win Streamies. I don't respect them more as a creator because they won a Streamie. Award shows are the most overrated thing. It's just for people who need validation.
No, but you got to, dude, we're living in the golden age of television.
What's that award you won?
Hey. We're living in the golden age of television.
I'm just kidding.
And now's the time that if Fargo is a top contender, the TV show, it's a top contender. We're talking about it's an HBO level show, the TV show. Check it out. I don't know. I mean, even the movie, it was like, I think it won Oscars, but maybe not. But the TV show is like a banger, dude. I mean, it's like we're talking about like everyone thinks it's beautiful.
I'm gonna check it out, guys. Guys,
check it out. Check it out.
It's been such a great chat.
It's been a great day.
Graham on.
We got Grahamsies.
We talked about the Forex Academy. And we talked about why you need to subscribe to The Drip. If you're not subscribed to The Drip right now, you're gonna miss out when we kill The Drip on Coffeezilla because Graham told us to.
Yeah, I wonder what the hits will be. Imagine even these people, we do it on The Drip channel and there's like 20 people in the live stream. Guys, one day we're going to go to the other channel. You guys got to come over there.
We need
a system of getting all these people on the new channel.
Yeah.
Subscribe.
For sure.
That's the system.
Jared Seinfeld saying, guys, how much did they pay you for the sponsorship for Fargo? That's funny. That's funny. All right, guys. Thanks for watching.
All right, Habibis.
Thanks for coming by.
Peace.
See ya, boys. See you later.